Order. Can we stand for a prayer by Councilman Nasuda, please?
Heavenly Father, we come to you today asking for your guidance, wisdom, and support. Help us to engage in meaningful discussions and prudent decision-making throughout this meeting. Continue to watch over our community and keep safe those that serve and protect us. We ask you bless and protect all those serving in the military, both home and abroad, as well as those preparing for deployment. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Amen.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, can I have roll call, please?
Councilor Nasuda.
Here.
Mayor Nelson.
Here.
Deputy Mayor Pisner.
Here.
Councilor Santinella.
Here.
Councilor Ungayer.
Here.
Councilor Sakala.
Here.
Councilor Crisati.
Here.
Councilor Finger.
Here.
Councilor Hendrickson.
Here.
Councilor Ludwig.
Here.
And Councilor Mangini.
Here.
11 members are present, none are absent.
Thank you. In the event of a fire and emergency, there are two means of exits the council chambers. Exit out the rear doors and walk a safe distance away from the building, or exit through the side doors, go down one flight of stairs, out the doors, and walk a safe distance away from the building. I'll entertain a motion for the minutes of the special meeting February 20, 2024.
So moved.
Motion's made and seconded. Are there any comments, corrections, or concerns? Seeing none, all in favor? Opposed? Abstentions? One abstention. And then moving to the regular meeting of February 20th, 2024.
So moved.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any questions, comments, or concerns? Seeing none, all in favor? Opposed? Abstentions? Two abstentions. Thank you. And now we're moving on to special guests. We have our Register of Voters, Lou Fiore and Tom Kensler. Welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Welcome. Thank you. Thank you for welcoming us, and thank you for having us back again. It's nice to see everybody again. I think we were just here last month. So, if you know, I'm Lou Fiore, the Democrat Registrar of Voters, and
Tom Kensler, Republican Registrar of Voters.
And again, I want to thank you very much for having us or letting us use this vehicle for our dog and pony show about the upcoming election in April, presidential primary election. And we're here to just do a couple quick statements about the election, how it's going to be handled, to remind people of what's going on with this primary, and also answer any questions you might have. So again, thank you so much for allowing us to be on your agenda. The presidential primary election date is April 2nd, which is 2 days after Easter. The state of Connecticut did change that date about a few months back. Originally, it was going to be towards the end of April, but they decided to change that to April 2nd, so it's right after Easter, which, you know, really makes it nice for Tom and I and our workers. But having that said, as normal, the locations will be open from 6 a.m. to 8 p.m. In addition to that, we will be using all of our traditional four locations: Enfield Street School, JFK, the Annex, Henry Barnard, and of course, we'll be doing absentee balloting, processing, and other things here at Town Hall. The nice news there is that we were in front of the Board of Education last week or the week before, and there will be no school that day. Originally, the school was scheduled for April 2nd. Based on some safety concerns we have at one or two of the elementaries, the Board of Education, based on a recommendation from the superintendent, decided to cancel school. So that makes it a lot easier for the residents to vote. There'd be less problems at the schools on that day. I want to also mention that this is a Democrat and Republican primary. Only Democrats and Republicans can vote in this primary. Unaffiliates cannot, people in the Independent Party cannot, people in the Green Party cannot. Any Democrat who wanted to change to a Republican, or vice versa, and Republican who wanted to change to a Democrat and vote in this primary, that window has passed. There's a 90-day waiting period, so they've missed that boat if they wanted to do that. And that same thing goes if you're an Independent Party or a Green Party. You can't change your party and think you're going to be able to vote in the primary. That's state of Connecticut law. Both political parties have agreed that they like that 90-day waiting period. We're pretty lucky in New York at 6 months, so we only have 90 days here. Unaffiliates are not allowed to vote in the primary. This is not like Massachusetts. You can't claim the party of the day and come and vote. Again, the Democrat and Republican parties here in the state of Connecticut do not allow unaffiliates to be able to claim themselves a party person and vote on that day. Having said that, unaffiliates have until around noontime on Monday, March 25th, that they can change to one of the major parties if they so desire.
And they won't have a waiting period.
They won't have a waiting period, okay? So again, unaffiliates, if you want to join a Democrat or Republican party to vote in the primary, you have until around noontime on Monday, March 25th to do so. In addition to that, if I'm not mistaken, absentee ballots will be ready on March 12th. As you can imagine, we work in consultation with our wonderful town clerk and her staff all the time. So absentee ballots will be available, start being mailed out on March 12th. Absentee ballots are available. As you know, the state of Connecticut did make some changes in that. There is, you know, for lack of a better term, an illness box now you can check if you believe you're ill or you're afraid you're going to get ill, and you can get an absentee ballot. Having said that, I wanted just to bring up a date on how this primary is going to be handled. Again, only Democrats and Republicans can vote, and they can't cross-vote. We basically put like a yellow tape line right down through our voting place so that a D can't get an R ballot and vice versa. There's no crossover here in the state of Connecticut. So having said that, I'm going to turn over to Tom, who's going to talk about early voting.
Thanks, Lou. For you folks and in the council and mainly for the public, we wanted to spend a minute and talk about early voting because it's the first time we're going to be doing this in the state. Early voting is going to encompass 4 days of early voting, and that's going to be on Tuesday the 26th, Wednesday the 27th, Thursday the 29th, and then Friday.
28th.
I'm sorry, 28th, and Good Friday.
No, Saturday the 30th.
Right, Good Friday, we're going to be closed for Good Friday. Then the fourth day is going to take place on Saturday. Then we're going to have no more early voting after that. So the 4 days for the public for early voting is Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Saturday prior to Easter. And it's going to be here at the town hall in the Enfield room. There'll be signage outside to direct people in. The hours of voting are going to be 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. As we talked in the past, we're a little fuzzy on how busy that will be, but we're preparing to handle a busier voting block than maybe some other towns and municipalities around the state are. Lou and I felt that it was a little more prudent to make sure we're staffed properly. So we'll have 5 or 6 people in that room throughout the entire voting process. So it'll be just like a polling place. In fact, we're calling it a polling place.
It has to be by law. It is a polling place. We'll have the 75-foot signs up there. There can be no soliciting. Basically, we pretty much commandeered a whole basement during those early voting period times. We're going to allow meetings in the Skidico room, because that's within the 75-foot area, and we're going to certainly allow the employees to use the break room, without a doubt. But there'll be no soliciting and no hanging around in the basement during those time periods, just like one of the school voting places by
now,
state statute.
Fortunately, Biden or Trump won't be here, so we don't have to worry about them crossing that 75-foot line. But when we have a municipal election, and if we're still doing early voting like we're going to be, that'll be the time where you have to be careful as candidates coming in and out of the building. Obviously, to do business, you'll be able to do that. So will our state reps. But just like a regular election, you can't go past that 75-foot mark with, you know, advertising regarding the election and, you know, wearing your favorite hat for the candidate you're rooting for, that type of thing. So I guess with that said, we want to just turn it over to you. And for the public benefit, if you have any questions, whether it's on the process, the backroom process or the voter process, please fire away.
Yeah. Is there a plan to put signage out front that says that there's going to be voting taking place here? I don't know if this is for you or through the mayor to the town manager.
We have signs too.
That say vote today here.
Early vote. We have early voting signs that are going to be put up.
And are they going to be anywhere else in town?
No, because we're only having early voting here.
Are there going to be signs anywhere else in town telling people that early voting is going on at town hall?
No, but I'm glad you asked the question because what I was just thinking before we got together here, if you folks and the town manager, the mayor through the town manager, if we could put some advertising up on our social media and wherever we're doing announcements these next few weeks, because that makes a big impact. Who sees that? Not everybody watches the meetings on YouTube, but a lot of people follow the Facebook page. And we can help you with putting together a, you know, something that's simple and easy and doesn't take up a lot of space, but that gets that message out so they come to the right place and the right times.
And not to discourage you, but we were basically advised by Secretary Sasoff that they were going to do most of the advertising in the state for each town for early voting. So that's one of the reasons why Tom and I haven't really done our own thing on it. We were going to meet to try to get our webpage updated a little bit with a couple statements, but they're supposed to be taking the lead on this.
So to my question, mm-hmm. what are they doing?
I have no idea.
We don't know yet.
Okay.
So that's another reason we're asking.
Yeah. Okay, that gives me no comfort. I want you to understand.
You see the comfort it gives us.
Like, well, you know me. You know me, Councilman Santana. I get it.
But look, it's new,
yep.
Right? This is new.
Yep.
The first time.
Yep.
And I mean, people need to just be aware, yep. whether they choose to exercise the early voting option or not. I just would like to know if you can somehow find out what the state is doing, and so we can figure out what we could possibly do at this late juncture to supplement that.
And that question, we're aggressive on asking that question and trying to get that information. But you're right; it's a. I haven't heard anything yet. Let's ask again. And let's ask again. So
less than 340 other registrars.
Right.
Yep. Okay. Thank you.
That's okay. That's a good question, though.
Thank you, John.
Oh, two questions. So why don't, can we, through the mayor to the town, why can't we put it on our website? I mean, it's a month out.
Yeah.
Again, for the record, I'm 100% against early voting. I think it's absolutely, I'm sorry, this is, you should be able to show up on one day with an ID. However, so having said that, you have 4 days actually now. What is the chain of security that we're going to have here? I mean, yeah. As a Christian, I appreciate not having on Good Friday, but... I have to be upfront. I'm kind of questioning the logic a little bit. Why wouldn't we do one on a Friday before instead of the Saturday before Easter? I'm just asking. I'm not questioning your decision, but it just seems.
I have your answer.
You have a day when no one's voting, and then we're going to expect people to show up on Saturday.
Wait, before you answer,
sorry, go ahead.
These hours and days were not our decision. It was all done by state legislature through a state act. Matter of fact, frank with you, the new Secretary of State was against these hours and days also. So the legislature took it upon themselves to anoint these days and times.
You give me a little hope by saying that.
Yeah, Mike, it had more to do with wanting to be earlier in the month ahead of other states.
I get the whole
was the genesis of all this.
But again, the security here, 4 days, what are we doing to make
okay,
sure?
Okay, so I got that for you. Yeah. So we're just finalizing today. We're going to be getting envelopes next week. We're going to see the envelopes that are going to have to be used to put the ballots in. The person signs it,
yeah.
And those get secured. And then we secure them after every day in our locking file cabinets in a fireproof vaulted traveling pack that sits in there, and then Sheila will take custody of them the next morning, and then the next day we'll do it again for another set, and they're sealed, they're locked, they're fireproof, and we're actually going to go out and buy the 5 or 6 that we're going to need based on what we think is going to happen. And basically you're going to have a couple hundred ballots in each of these, right, that are going to be secure in that office, both in a fireproof safe and in a fireproof its individual safe, locked.
So secure. Having said all that, so technically, right, so you could still file an absentee ballot. So you could actually, so someone could actually mail their ballot and we could be getting them on Sunday. So technically you could be going from what, Tuesday to Tuesday, right? So we have cameras on where, so is only here is where we can accept absentee ballots?
No, we accept absentee ballots here.
Right, I'm saying, but we have booths around town. Is it only here they can put them? That's my, I guess, my question.
No.
Can I back up a second?
Go right
ahead.
Yeah.
You're kind of mixing.
Right, that's why. This is very confusing.
So again, the early voting, at the end of the night, we're going to take the people who come and vote early voting, we're going to take the ballots out. The ballots are in an envelope, sealed envelope. And we're going to put them in a fireproof bank bag that has a lock on it. We're then going to take those ballots and put them in a fire waterproof file cabinet that the council was nice enough to purchase for us a few years back, if you remember. If you don't want to see them, come to the office, we're showing to you. don't know how they're going to move them to put the carpet in, by the way. They're going to stay in overnight. Only very few people, only Tom and I have the key to get into that fireproof cabinet, okay? At 8:30 the next morning, or if you don't mind, 9, please chime in if you want, Sheila.
I was thinking
9 o'clock. Sheila's going to come and get, we're going to turn over those ballots to her, and we're going to officially turn over this paperwork we have to sign, or all three of us have to sign, and she's going to take those ballots and put them in the big vault here in the town clerk's office.
Got it.
That's under camera, that's got, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So that takes care of the early voting ballots.
And they're going to be there till after Tuesday at 8 o'clock?
They will be there till Tuesday morning whenever Sheila comes in and turns them over to us.
Yep. Right.
We haven't negotiated that time yet.
So in the crossover, we're working a lot of extra hours in this because now we have to, as you know, when the absentee ballots come in, there's a point in time where Lou and I sit down and take every absentee ballot from the town clerk and go through them one by one and check them off in the books so that the person can't vote in live.
I appreciate all you're doing. So what happens if there's a some sort of breach, something happens? What if I don't know, it's something
happens.
Well,
I'm going to answer the rest of your question and see if you still have one. Now, the early voting, that person comes in on Wednesday and early votes. And then they try to send an absentee ballot in the next day. Or they say, well, I sent my absentee ballot in, but I want to early vote. I like that. I'm going to go do that instead. But I already sent my absentee ballot in. The two will cross paths at the same time when we sit down to do the book. So every day the book is done, there won't be an ability for anyone to vote twice. Just like there isn't with absentee ballots.
Right.
And you saw that when we did the
I get it, but this concerns me. I'm going to be honest. Not because of you two, not because of you two, because of the process.
There's no way, unless we made an error, unless we made or our deputies made an error, there's no way that anyone can vote twice.
All right.
Believe me. I mean, we have a down pat.
Good.
There's no way, unless we made an error, no one could vote twice.
So it just added a lot of work because now instead of 3 hours of putting in absentee ballots on, say, Saturday before an election, we're doing it every day to update
Monday
the
morning.
Books.
We're doing absentee ballot Monday morning.
But the early voting.
Thank you through the mayor to Sheila. So what about absentee? Are we having one Dropbox or all Dropbox still going to be open even though there's only voting here?
There's only voting here for early voting, but absentee ballot laws have not changed at all. All the boxes will be open, and I'll be running to all of them every day, just like I do.
It makes no sense to me. It makes no sense.
You have to have every ballot.
Not on you. It makes no sense. If we're going to have
every ballot box you get from the state, you have to have open.
Yeah, I appreciate it. I'm sorry. I'm not trying to be difficult.
Okay.
Not trying to be difficult.
You bring up a good point.
Yeah.
The state statute. They didn't.
I get it.
The
least amount of opportunity.
Best of luck. I mean, I agree. I think this process is silly, in my opinion. That's just me. But I know you both will take. Every vote matters, no matter who they vote for. So I know that's all that matters through this process. So, if there is stuff that happens, I hope that we will know about it so we can clean it up.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, it's not on you. It's on us. So thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. That's our hope, too.
Yeah.
Thank you. Councilman Finger.
Thank you, Mayor. So to piggyback off of Councilor Santinella, DPW's got those big A-frames, the 4x4s.
Yeah.
So instead of waiting for the state to determine what they're going to do for us here, why can't we, through the mayor to the town manager, why can't we just put out our own A-frames and put out the early voting dates and times and make it easier for people? Because there's a lot of people that don't have internet. They don't go to the town manager's website. They don't watch YouTube. They don't do any of this stuff. So the more information that we give out to our taxpayers, our voters, the better off that they will feel better about it. Instead of saying, I never saw that. I would like to do that, but I never saw it.
So, Councilman Finger, are you asking us to request Donald Nunes and staff to build us 5 new A-frames?
You don't have to build new ones. We have them already.
Yeah,
put them on every election.
They just say vote today.
Well, they can change the sign. They don't have to change. They don't have to make new ones. They can make new signs.
They don't have to paint over that. Those are painted.
No. That's all vinyl. And they're on chloroplast boards, so they can unscrew them and put new ones on.
Okay.
That's all it is, just the chloroplast board.
We will ask Donald if he can do that.
I would ask through the town manager, so that's why I'm doing it my way.
That's okay. We'll do it our way, too.
Okay, thank you.
Well, we also don't want to change the existing signs because they're going to need them election day.
Right.
You're not changing the signs.
Right, that's...
Oh, I got it. So you're saying temper, not vinyl letters. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I understand.
Mm-hmm. I never knew. I thought they were actually painted right on the wood frames.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. Everybody all set? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you again. Thank you for having us do this dog and pony.
No problem, and good luck.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Good night, everybody.
Okay, now we're moving on to public communication. Any person who wishes to address the council shall first be recognized by the chair and shall state their name and address for the record. They shall limit their remarks to 5 minutes. After each person who desires has had a chance to speak, those desiring to speak a second time will be permitted to do so and shall limit their remarks to 3 minutes. During public communication item number 7 on the agenda, public members shall limit their remarks to 2 rounds, 8 minutes. During public communication item 16 on the agenda, if prior to 11 p.m., each person shall limit their remarks to 3 minutes. Public communication shall be limited to 1 hour unless extended by a majority vote of the council. All remarks shall be addressed to the council as a whole and not to any individual member. All remarks to the administration of the town shall be addressed to the town manager and not the individual employees. Public members shall observe proper decorum and good conduct and shall refrain from personalities and improper language. Who would like to come up? Come on up, Bill.
Bill Hosley, 30 Old Abbey Road in Enfield. Is that it? My name is Bill Hosley. I'm a 38-year resident of Enfield and have been a member of the Enfield Historical Society since the 1990s, also a donor, contributor, and former trustee. Enfield just hired a tourism director. Tourism is a competitive business that depends on having treasures folks will travel to see. Parks, museums, and historic buildings also enrich the lives of families and children who live here. The Martha Parsons house is an Enfield treasure, far more than most know. We must save it from the intent of the Historical Society to sell it and disperse most of its collections. Miss Parsons donated her family's 18th century house and household possessions going back centuries together with an endowment. Most people in the room have probably never been there. It has a too low public profile. The museum was open seasonally on Sundays from 2 to 4. With little promotion and few public programs to draw attention, it is not very accessible. My wife and I together have 80 years of experience in museum operations at Wadsworth Athenaeum, Connecticut Historical Society, Windsor Historical Society, and Connecticut Landmarks, which owns and operates a chain of house museums, including the Phelps Hathaway House in Suffield. I'm willing to provide a plan that will turn things around. None of this is easy. Running any kind of museum involves marketing, fundraising, volunteer and staff coordination, public programming, and of course, a passion for and understanding of the content of what we have. Whether this house or the incredible archaeology of the Skantic Linear Park. Enfield Historical Society has a museum in the old town hall that everyone should see. Alas, they are down to less than 120 paying members with a membership that starts at $10. People are busy and not everyone cares, at least until they are exposed to it. A town with 40,000 residents can do much, much better. I'd like to round up a group to help save the Martha Parsons House. I would like this matter to be taken up as an agenda item at a future town council meeting. I would like the Enfield Historical Commission to help grapple with this, and I would especially like to stop the sale. Gone is gone forever. And I'll just leave a couple of these little handouts over on the table there that have my contact information, and hopefully we'll see you again. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Ma'am?
Okay, Diane Stelmat, Clear Street in Enfield. I'm going to start with number 2 because about the early voting. I work at Costco, as I see most of you there all the time. I'm just going to suggest the A-frames could go right there because 99% of the town drives in and out of there. Whether they shop or get a hot dog, they're in there. So there's a good spot to put it. Right, John? Okay, so that I wasn't even going to say anything. What I'm here for, really, I'm tired, I'm bitchy, and I'm hungry, so this ain't going to come out good. I called social services today to make my senior repair appointment from the senior repair program, and it's no longer available. They did give me a phone number for something called Your Community Cares. Could give me no information on it. They apologize for that. I've got a call in with, and they're going to get back to me. I have used them. I am born and raised here. I am 66 plus years old. They've done gutters for me twice a year. I'm surrounded by trees, so I have to do spring and fall. Air conditioners in and out. They've replaced faucets for me, hung blinds. They even secured a railing I had no idea I should have had secured because it was wobbly on my steps. So saved me from breaking a hip. The only thing they said it was a liability issue. I volunteer in this town, at the senior center, at the library. Is that going to all stop too? For liability if I get hurt there, and I do fishes and loaves. I know that's not a town thing, but we need to keep this. I use it. I'm single, I have a house. Save it, please save it. I have used it for a lot of years. Where's Marie? Oh, she's up there. She's a big advocate of it, so help. John's a big advocate of it. Help. My gutters need cleaning now, so help. And I volunteer. I hope it has nothing to do with the volunteer tax program where you volunteer and, you know, we're going to get the $400 off. I mean, I've been doing it longer than that's been available, so I'm taking advantage of it. Last year, I already got mine in for this year. So that's all I have to say. I'm not staying tonight. I've been up since 3:30 because Costco's needed me at 5. Then I volunteered for 4 hours. So I'm going to go home, have a peanut butter sandwich, and watch you on TV and see what you have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Diane.
You're welcome.
Jen.
It's too warm in here.
I have to go after that.
I'll be watching. I'll be home in 2 minutes.
All right. Thank you. Good evening. Jennifer Krasinkevich, 209 Abbey Road. I've been here before along with my partner in crime back there, Bobby, Barbara. I just wanted to state that my neighbor and I began this discussion with you, the town council, back on November 20th of 2023. Not having received any actual notification of what the precious farmland behind our homes were in store for. As mentioned previously, a lot of sifting and surveying of the land was taking place around that time with no notification to the surrounding neighbors. We left that meeting feeling hopeful that the town heard us and would do everything possible to help us stop the farmland from becoming a home to an eyesore known as a solar farm. Not farming at all. As luck or unluck would have it, once attending this meeting, we coincidentally received a priority mail letter dated November 20th. This letter was being sent as notice because I'm listed as the owner of the land that abuts the property. As per the letter, we were to await the formal intention for the solar energy company to file a petition of declaratory ruling, again called a petition, with the Connecticut Siting Council. As this petition will seek approval of the location and construction of an approximately 1.93 megawatt solar photovoltaic project to be located at 141 Town Farm Road,
Sorry, I'm very emotional. Several council members reached out to us and actually came to my neighbor's home to express their concerns with yet again another section of Enfield farmland to be taken over by solar. I'm not against solar. I'm against filling valuable farmland with solar. Once it's built, we'll be losing the productivity farmland forever. In researching solar farms, the life expectancy is 20 to possibly 30 years. Once this time has passed, the land is no longer suitable for farming again. And currently, the U.S. does not have any answer to properly disposing of solar panels. Studies show life expectancy is approximately 40% less than originally forecasted. Technology will also cause solar panels to become obsolete, I hope. We can't afford to lose any more ground than we've already lost. Development on agricultural land is never a sustainable solution, especially for a small town like ours. What are the health risks living in near a solar farm, again, which would be 30 feet from my property? The scientists at WHO, World Health Organization, believe that EMFs can damage the body's cells, affect oxygen levels, and cause the nervous system to overreact to stimuli. Cancer may occur with high levels of EMF exposure. Children and small animals are more susceptible. Other symptoms may be included. The list goes on and on with regards to sleeping problems, including insomnia, headaches, hair loss, fertility, depression, and depressive symptoms, fatigue, and lethargy. Concentration problems, memory recall, dizziness, irritability, loss of appetite, restlessness, and anxiety, which I have already. There's noise and light pollution. The panels emit a humming noise, and farms are brightly lit, causing sleep disruption at night. And they also emit heat. If you're close to them and the breeze blows just the right way, you will feel it. The negative effects this will have on our flora and fauna are untold. This destroys local wildlife and ecosystems. The panels can kill insects, birds, and other creatures as a result of the EMF. Again, I was going to go on and on about all that. Rainwater washes many of these toxins out of the fragments of the solar modules over time. And these toxins leach into our water ponds and swamps. Not only will you not want to look at it, which I don't, but when you decide to move, nobody's going to want to buy your property because they don't want to look at it either. Your property value is being drastically reduced as I read this to you tonight. Please join us in supporting our community and say no to solar farms. You know what? They say there's strength in numbers, and I do agree with that. But I also feel so proud that my neighbor, Bobby, Barbara, stepped up and we were heard. This is a very emotional topic for me. This site is less than 30 feet behind my home. What a waste. I really cannot thank you all enough, and I look forward to the possibility of the intervener that you spoke of in the last town council meeting and Enfield taking over the right on how Enfield should be accountable to what Enfield would like to do with our own town. I thank you. Sorry for being emotional. Thank you.
Thank you, Jen.
Yeah, and the other item I wanted to mention is the JA was kind enough to put a nice article out in the paper, but unfortunately, the site that they have here in the photo is not where I live. This is not my backyard. This is where a mailbox is located, I think, for that property. So I invite the JA to come out to my house, Bobby's house, and any of the surrounding neighbors who would have loved to have been here tonight as well. So again, thank you.
Thank you. Marianne.
Good evening, Mary Ann Turner, Seven Meadow Road. I'm actually here with my economic development hat on. I've heard that there's some people that think that we, when we sit on commissions, we're not supposed to come in front of you, but I don't think that. I think you're actually the right body sometimes. I'm here to encourage you where Mr. Hosley spoke about the Marston Parsons house. I have been in there, and if you haven't seen the Washington wallpaper, you're missing something. And Bill is correct. We can't afford to lose any more of our heritage. We put everything we had, and we're still working on it, to get the Hazardville Institute up and moving. We lost our downtown in Thompsonville because we had some opportunities back 60 years ago that hasn't worked out quite as much as, or as well as we had hoped. And we're 60 years later trying to recoup it. Economic development supports historic buildings, artifacts, parks. And we see that as something that draws people to our community. I know that all of you have put money towards lots of things. Let's use the Higgins Park that Mayor Ludwig was very much behind. We don't want to see that gone, and someday it too will be old. The Marston Parsons house needs to be saved. And if that means we all need to collectively put our 2 cents together, and as one person just said this evening, strengthen numbers, I'm putting my hand up and saying I want to help. I think economic development should help. I think that Mr. Hosley and his wife, who are really, we should wrap our arms around them to have that much talent in our town willing to show and to put that to use. And I strongly advise it. I know the Historic Society, and I will be the first to admit I didn't know it was a $10 fee, but I will be buying my, I'll be putting my money towards them as soon as tomorrow. You sometimes just don't know what you don't know. But the Historic Society needs to be slowed down. I asked the council to invite the leadership of that group to share their divestiture plan and to ensure that this asset, because that's exactly what this is dealt with suitably and with reasonable protections applied. We cannot afford to lose it. And I'm hoping that you will take me up on my offer, and that I'm sure my board, I spoke to just one, so the rest of them don't know why I'm up here, but I will be reaching out to them afterwards. And so that's the reason I'm here, and I look forward to hearing from you.
Thank you, Marianne. Danielle.
Danielle Girard, Edgewood Drive. Transparency has been the theme this year from all sides. The most recent decisions for the armed guards and other items have not been fully transparent. In the last 2 weeks since the decision of the armed guards was made, the public has been told that this is a sensitive topic and many pieces of school security could not be shared. While we do understand this, the resolution was read out loud during the last town council meeting. However, there was nothing in the resolution that was read out loud that prevented you from informing the public sooner. The biggest question we all have is, why was this not in the packet for the agenda? You all speak so much about transparency, and yet this was your chance to be just that, and you failed. Considering the last time the armed guards were in the schools, the public expressed that they did not want them. The public was not informed, had no opportunity to express their concerns or talk about their options. The public should have been involved in this decision. Dr. Kelnin spoke last week about tabling the vote and allowing the public to have a community conversation about this topic. That would have been a great opportunity for you all to once again be transparent. We are all looking for an update on a few items that have recently been approved and money has been allocated. First off, the Powder Hollow project. Have we broken ground on this? And will it affect our kids playing for the spring season? Brainerd Park lights. Where are we in the process of this? Will this affect the women's and men's league playing for the spring and summer season? Field assessments, have these been done yet? If so, when can we expect feedback from this? High school field drainage repair project, when can we expect this to start? If we can give a suggestion to the town council and town manager, Can we have this updated on the town manager's website? Having the public informed about where you are in the above projects or even future projects will allow for more trust in the decisions that are being made and more transparency. We understand that things may not happen quickly with these above items, but please take in consideration that registrations are already happening for the fields that may be affected by this. We have also seen a lot of money being moved around, and our fear is that it will continue to be moved, and then these projects will not be completed. Like I have said in my past public comments, can we please just finish a project already? Thank you.
Thank you, Danielle. Amanda.
Good evening, Amanda Pickett, Guild Street. I'm here tonight as a resident and an Enfield Public School parent. I made my comments as a Board of Ed member on these matters at our meeting last week on February 27th. I hope that all of you have watched that meeting. I do want to ensure that my comments are not misconstrued. So I will clearly state that at no point have I ever said that I do not support school security. Let me reiterate, my children are in those schools. What I did say is that no other options were explored. And that is the truth. Only one option was given, your idea of armed guards. And I think it's important for the public to be aware that this new idea didn't come from the Board of Ed, and it is not cost neutral. No matter how hard you try to paint the decision for armed guards as a way to help the education budget or potentially save staff cuts, you will never find a right way to do the wrong thing. And spending $1 million on armed security without ever engaging our public and ever exploring other options that may truly meet the needs of our students and staff is the wrong thing. Your actions since you've gained control have been to suppress the public voice, and this decision's a prime example of that. So now here we are. Decision's been made. So now what? You still have cuts to make. There's no way you're going to cut taxes or even keep them the same without something giving. So what's going to give? You have some options available. You can give the public the perception that maybe you'll cut or flat fund the PD. But tonight, you're going to approve 12 new jobs. And guess what? They have 22 new jobs waiting for them as armed security. You can tell the public that you can't support the education budget as presented because you're giving them this gift. Well, guess what? This isn't the gift our students or our staff need for education. That's what our budget's for. So what's the right thing to do? You need to fully fund education and find your cuts elsewhere. Remember when I came here and said that there are consequences for your actions? Well, I refuse to allow our kids and staff to bear the consequences for your decisions. Let me remind you all, you're 11 elected individuals. Please fully fund education.
Thank you, Amanda. George.
George Young, A. Holly Lane. I plan to talk about schools later on the 5-3 program here. I plan to speak about some of the numbers that have gone into the town budget and its impact on your wallet. This is a brief English summary of what happened in the use of estimates. Most of the comments I'm about to make are mine based on the information on a couple of sheets of papers that was provided to me by the finance director. I spent some time with the question, how do we compute the mill rate and where does the money come from? This is probably about fourth or fifth grade math, except the numbers are a little larger. Just divide the gross taxes needed to cover the expenses by the net taxable grand list as adjusted. And lo and behold, you get a factor. That's easy, right? But wait, there's more. Since the mill rate is per $1,000 of valuation, we then multiply the factor by 1,000 to get the mill rate on your real estate and personal property, which becomes 30.56 in fiscal year 24. The sky is the limit for the town to bill you on that. However, the state of Connecticut sets the maximum mill rate for motor vehicles at 29.21. So you see a higher rate of 30.56 on real estate and personal property taxes for the town and the BOE. Don't go by the brochure that came with your tax bill because That has the wrong motor vehicle rate. I hate to think it was right, because that means we were all overbilled for our motor vehicle taxes. This year, the town has increased its budget of expenses from $72.1 million in fiscal 23 to $77.4 million in fiscal 24. That's an astounding increase of $5.3 million. That probably explains why there was $5 million of the fund balance transferred to cover expenses for some town expenses, or your taxes would have been even higher. In addition, the Board of Education budget went from $73.3 million in fiscal 23 to $75.9 million in fiscal 24, or an increase of just $2.6 million. But that was a combined increase of $7.9 million that our tax dollars had to finance this year. Counselors, I know that I was not happy about that increase, and I'm sure you weren't either. It is even worse when you realize that there was an assessment valuation increase in town of slightly over $33 million to bring our town's valuation up to $3.7 billion on October 1, 23. Remember, that was after the BAA estimated reduction of $32 million, which is similar to 10-1-22 estimated reduction, which offsets the estimated supplemental motor vehicle increase valuation of $40 million, which incidentally is the same estimate as the prior year. The council will have to do some fancy adjustments now for fiscal 25 to keep the same mill rate, because the net taxable value as of 10-1-24 was not higher than 10-1-23. Which is the starting point for the mill rate. I've seen a lot of estimates in our budget forecasting over the years, which I can understand why it is done, but at the same time, there needs to be a review of the estimates. For example, the town has estimated, since the WPC separated on its own about 5 years ago, that they should pay the town $390,000 per year for services that the town attorney, the town manager, and others have provided yearly to the WPC. In addition, the WPC also transfers $37,731 to the Information Technology Group Department, which has also been estimated for the same amount during the same 5 years. Don't forget that what the WPC pays out, you cover in your quarterly water bill payment for water usage. Water and sewer uses, I should say. Let's get these estimates more in line with the costs associated with them. I tried to simplify a complicated process for all of us, hopefully. This council seems to be heading in the same directions as prior councils. After using up the $13 million of ARPA funds, the council does not have enough to cut back expenses, nor do they do enough. Once again, it looks like some of the counselors are bailing out to try and get a state paid representative job. I say stay here and finish the job you were elected to do. Take a good look at every department and let's justify the expenditures and the number of employees needed, and if the department itself is needed, and reduce our mill rate accordingly. The council will inform us of their decision on the resolution in item 13C tonight on the agenda, which is the waiving of bids for roof replacements. I would hope that it is voted down.
George.
The replacement of windows, roofs.
How much you got left? Because your time's
up. One second.
Okay, go ahead.
It has waited this long, and a bid process should take place to secure the best possible price, product, and workmanship to do the best job. There is no emergency here. Thank you.
Thank you, George.
Hopefully.
Sir.
Good evening, Council. John Cox, Abbey Road. I'm also here to talk about the solar farm petition that's going in to the CT sitting council. It is petition number 1611. All this information is available publicly online. I highly recommend that you look at the documents. They have 9 different segments, site plan, the equipment specifications and operations and maintenance plan, a decommissioning plan, a butters notification, which sort of went out, certificate of surface, environmental assessment, noise analysis, and carbon debt. There are a few questions I would like to pose about these documents to the council. Within the operations and maintenance plan, there's something called the spill prevention, control, and countermeasures plan. It is all about preventing oil and other hazardous materials from being released into the environment. Within this plan, the they have to, per the Connecticut General Statutes 22A-450, have, quote, any and immediate spill, so any amount of material that is spilled anywhere on the property, they need to report it to the DEEP and a whole bunch of other regulatory bodies. Within their operations and maintenance plan, they have, quote, monitoring 24 hours a day. This monitoring that they're seeing, that they're saying they have, seems to be the utilization of the solar cells themselves, not necessarily a person in the space to see whether or not any material has leaked within the area. And the house that my wife and I live on, we have a private well that is below grade of the proposed site, and I really don't want to be drinking hazardous materials. I did that enough as a hazardous waste technician. So again, the life expectancy of these solar farms are, again, 25 to 30 years. The decommissioning plan says we'll put it back, if I am to paraphrase. That doesn't mean much without knowing what the town is going to look like in 25 to 30 years. So again, if we could have more information on what that could actually look like and whether or not that's appropriate to do. The environmental assessment mentions the deep aquifer protection area. While it is not close, or it is not within the aquifer area outlined by DEEP, it is fairly close and it is above the same sediments, meaning that the unconfined aquifer in the area, which is how my wife and I get our water in our home, is a fairly high amount of hydraulic conductivity, which means basically how easily water moves through the sediments. Because it's all sand and gravel, water moves pretty quickly in the ground through that area. And I, again, don't want to be drinking hazardous materials. That's, I guess, a personal preference. The CT DEEP, again, decided where that aquifer protection area was based on the United States Geological Survey. If you look at the CT state surficial geology map, you see that the area that the proposed site plan is has a very similar surficial geology to the area that has been set aside by the CT DEEP for the aquifer protection area. They had to draw the line somewhere, and it happens to be just outside of where the site is. The CT Sitting Council has the Council of Environment within that group. They had a few notes, but they did not touch on groundwater, unfortunately. I wish they would, because that is something that my wife and I are very concerned about. But they refer to the land within the site as prime farmland. So if we lose that, what does it do to the town? How much are we willing to let that go? They recommend getting the Department of Agriculture to have some input on this petition. And they also recommend retaining as much topsoil that is removed from the site as possible. If that could be done practically is a matter for the Department of Agriculture. And then the CT General Statute Section 1-1 Subsection Q defines farms as the cultivation of the soil, paraphrasing, for agricultural or horticultural commodities. And then skipping down to the end of that definition, nothing herein shall restrict the power of the local zoning authority under Chapter 124. I assume that local zoning authority to be the Enfield Zoning Board. It is currently zoned as, I believe, I wrote it down, R-44, residential 44. meaning it's zoned for residential only. Farming is allowed, but you need a special permit for utilities within that zoning area. So I recommend to the council and then to the town at large to look into whether or not we have authority under council bylaws, town bylaws, to step in and say, this is the way the laws are written at the state level. We have the authority here to make sure that we want to keep our town safe. Thank you.
Thank you. Robert.
Robert Bukowski, 21 Francis Avenue. Good evening, Mr. Mayor and councilors. Tonight I'd like to discuss school safety as well as the emotional safety and well-being of the students of Enfield. First of all, I fully support the idea of armed guards in schools. I know this might not be financially possible, but personally, I would prefer to see this occur with active duty armed Enfield police officers with arrest powers reporting to the police chain of command, financed by the town, not the BOE. These officers, God forbid, if ever required to protect students in an active shooter situation, would be required to risk their lives and aggressively disarm a shooter. A fully trained active duty officer is the best qualified person for such a job. Let's also not forget about reasonable infrastructure fortifications as well. Door locks, window locks, cameras should also be considered. There are some classroom doors that at present do not even lock from the inside, and these are reasonable upgrades. Now, with that said, there's more to student safety and student well-being than just police protection. And this next part will make sense to you if you've watched the February 14th Board of Ed meeting, specifically minute marker 1 hour and 14 minutes. If you haven't seen it, then I would request you go home and watch it. Continuing on about student safety, children need to be educated in an environment where moral and ethical standards are high. There's absolutely no place in the Enfield school system for assignments such as Pizzagate for middle school boys and girls. I can only hope that a situation like that will never occur again. There's no place in the Enfield school system for sexually charged, age-inappropriate library books. There's no place in the Enfield school system for pajama day. Raising money for Connecticut Children's Medical Center is a good thing, a very good thing. But the type of fundraising event is very inappropriate. There are 100 other ways a school district can raise money for charity that do not include adult teachers, BOE members, and students of all ages romping and frolicking around the classroom together. This type of behavior blurs, if not destroys, the healthy professional distance that should exist between teacher and student. There is no place at all in Enfield for drag shows for children or drag reading rooms for children. All of the previously mentioned issues are issues that certain members of the school board, past and present, and administration have supported and defended. Children need to be protected against the repulsive, disgusting, and morally corrupt attitudes and indoctrinating behaviors of certain present and past school board members and school officials. And yes, I'll be saying this presentation in front of the BOE next week also. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. No. Angela.
Is this our class assignment for the day?
Yes, that's right.
Thank you. No, she won't be back for a month.
Good evening, Angela Foss, 16 Crescent Beach Drive. Again, thank you for all that you do. I really do mean that. So again, I'm going to talk about Parkman School only because I did watch the last town council meeting and I did hear the little, you know, little quick remark that there might be conversation tonight about the roof. So I did check on the website, town website, and I see that there is no bidding yet for the town for that roof. And I'm expecting that bids should be begun soon because we do need a new roof and it needs to be like ASAP, please. And I know you're the ones in charge of that. So in case you haven't had a chance to watch March 1st, 2020 special meeting, I've included the minutes for you in this packet. And it talks about the priorities for the roofs and the referendum. And Parkman was number one on the roof referendum. And it was number one to be completed. And this was passed in 2021. So now we're years beyond that and nothing's happened. Parkman roof was put in 1994 and that's 30 years ago. And that's why the roof is in poor condition. And that's why we have birds flying into the school from the ceiling. That's why we have buckets all over the place. That's why we have the tiles in the ceiling. If you walk in, you'll be able to see the tiles are all white on two sides, on the two edges, and not in the middle. Why? Because they have to change the tiles. In some cases, daily. In some cases, daily. They don't want you to see that when you walk in there, there is all this deterioration happening and all the rain dripping in. So in some cases, that poor custodian is changing those tiles daily. So there are pictures in here that show all just basic pictures of the roof. Here it is, the roof 2021 proposed schedule. Parkman number one, poor and 27 years old, and this is 4 years old. Here is the roof's continuation list, and the central library at that point was only 15 years old, but that obviously needs to be replaced because you're talking about the library needing replaced, right? That you want to have that taken care of. Then we have this kind of roof that says it's a built-up roof composed of layers of fabric and that it only has a life expectancy of 15 to 30 years. And the DPW concerns recommendations roof 2021 will provide adequate time for the town council to save funds for the next phase of roofing investments. That's what it states on here. Here's a picture of Parkman roof from an aerial photo. You can see all that darkness in the middle. Well, that's the water collecting on the roof. And that's because it's this kind of a roof. And these pictures were taken in 2021. It's falling apart. It has water collections. And these were not created by me. This was in that 2021 presentation by Mr. Nunes and other people on the staff. Here are the ceiling tiles being taken down. And I could take this picture all the time. Piles of ceiling tiles taken down, the holes in the ceiling because there's, you know, buckets underneath that need to be replaced and on. And then I have a letter from the gym teacher. This is the newer roof and it's in your packet as well. The gym roof has experienced multiple leaks and repairs for several years. As a result, in some places, the floor has sustained damage, such as warping and wood stains. When the roof leaks, puddles are formed in the floor. Buckets are then placed on the floor to catch the water until the water on the roof is evaporated, drained, or the roof is repaired. During this time, physical education classes and recreation activities experience a disruption and hazard with the buckets and water in the gym. The bottom line, the roof needs to be replaced to avoid future disruptions to the educational process and hazardous safety conditions to the PE students and the Enfield Parks and Recreation at Parkman School, signed by the PE teacher. So that is my concern with the roof, and I hope to God that you guys don't change your mind. I know that that's what you have committed to do, is fix our roof. And we need it done ASAP. We've talked about this. So I was expecting there'd be something bid-wise going out, but nothing's happening yet. So please push the town to get this going, please. Then I wanted to talk about prioritizing your budget. I know it's three minutes later on.
You're 30 seconds over.
Oh, so thank you.
I was occupied reading.
Walter.
Walter J. Kruzel, 21 Charlie Road. I have a report from the eastern side of towns on the other side of the tracks. Guess what? Somebody came out from under his shell, and I'm going to sing it to you. He's been working on the railroad until the beer runs dry. Last Friday, today, they've been working on the railroad. Why? Because you guys were talking about it a couple weeks ago. So he came out from under his shell, and he started putting tracks down. This has been a 30-year joke. Really has. That him and somebody from the state came in front of a council, the previous council, and lied to you. I mean, that's something that happens in Washington now with the guy on the left there, but it happened back then. He lied to you. He came here and said that they're going to put all the freight rail from that railroad to that railroad. And when the question came up that East Long Meadow just finished their bike path, they said, no problem, we'll tear it up and put a new rail in there. I'm like, are you kidding me? You fill in the blank. There's no way that East Long Meadow's going to tear up a brand new bike path and put rail in. It's not going to happen. So he lied to you. So that's my report from there. About the BOE. My predecessor, when I was chairman, my predecessor to chairman said this every year. We are being shorted from the state for special education. Special education is supposed to be funded from the state 100%. It hasn't been funded 100% for 20 years. Until the state, now we're at the right picture. Until the state, you know, fulfills their funds. And these are funds that have been available since we were a colony and they sold the land that went out to the Mississippi River for the other states. And all that money was pulled in, and that's where we're supposed to use that money for education. That's what my predecessor always preached. So until that happens, then of course education's gonna go up. And then my last thing is, I missed last meeting, was the Four Chaplains Mass was earlier last month. 209 people attended, which was, could have had more. Lucian did a phenomenal job speaking during Mass and spelled out the whole history of it. We're the only town that celebrate the Four Chaplains in the country. The only one. They've been doing it for 6 years now. So I'd like to see 300 next year if we could. But he's been pushing to try to get people to come to parades too. So good luck with that. Well, that's my singing lesson for today. So, and I'm going home. So good night.
Thank you, Walter. Peter.
Good night.
Peter Janitis, 3 Farmstead Circle. Just going to hit random topics here. One, the armed guards. Some people are speaking out quite loudly about not having the armed guards. At the board of meeting, we posted that we would be discussing the security issue. You guys brought it up, I guess, at your last meeting. And at the Board of Ed meeting, we had 5 people speak against it. Tonight, you just had 2 more people speak. Both of them spoke at the last Board of Ed meeting also. Solar farms, my wife and I just did another trip between board meetings, and we got all the way down to Alabama, Georgia, Smoky Mountains again. We saw 4 solar farms. I was purposely looking for them on the roads that we were driving. Saw 4. 1 big one and 3 small ones. That's all I saw. I mean, I wasn't driving down all the roads looking for them, but they just there. And how many do we have in this town? These people who are against the solar farms near their property, God, I hope you can do something for them. Flags, you guys had a controversial flag issue. Driving back, one in Virginia and one in West Virginia. If you've ever seen the big American flag down at the Big Y down in East Windsor, 2 Confederate flags right along the highway. So who's to say what flags you want to fly? I think you guys made a good decision there. When it comes time for people saying that we are spending $5 million more on the town council, $2.6 million on the last budget for the Board of Ed, and $13 million in ARPA funds, which party was in control when all this happened? And as far as the roofs, having gone to a joint facility meeting, and you were there also, Jim, I thought that the kid, I wish I could remember his name, I can't remember it, but he gave a really good explanation about the bidding process, how when you bid on these roofs, it takes about a 6-month process. You send in your application, you get something back, you got to send them something back. And then once you do finally get your amount of money that you're going to get for the roofs, you can't do it when the kids are in school. So you got to work on a school vacation and or just during the summer. And that's basically it. I think you guys are doing a good job so far. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Sir.
Good evening. My name is Lewis Martin. I live at Jackson Road here in Enfield. I'm also a teacher here in Enfield at JFK Middle School. I would like to put forth my voice to encourage you to support the education budget as it has been proposed. The budget as proposed is not increasing or decreasing any programs or staff, or just keeping the status quo. The children of Enfield are, from my vantage point, being served very well by what your staff is currently doing. Teachers are working extremely hard, sometimes, you know, with limited funding in areas and limited staffing in other areas. And you heard about roofs. It's a small thing, but I literally bought pencils for my class just the other day. And it's a very small thing, but it's like I had to use my own money. And it's not a huge expense, but I know many teachers within my building that have personally funded projects of much larger dollar amounts than just pencils. And so I would just encourage you to think carefully about what the service that the teachers of Enfield are providing to your children and how we want to continue providing services to that same level, but we're beholden to you for the financials to make that possible. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else for the first time? We got about 2. Come on up, George. The hour's almost up.
I've been watching a clock. George Young, 8 Holly Lane. There was a public notice appearing in the JI on February 29th this year, asking for bids for the redevelopment instead of selling Nathan Hale Elementary School. Didn't we just do the same thing 7 years ago? Where are we going with this? The taxpayers never seem to know what is going on from the council. What additional funds are we going to need after we do this? Speaking of schools, we don't need armed guards in the schools, and if we do, why hasn't the cost of that been discussed with the public? I don't care what pocket it's coming from, because it's the taxpayers who are paying for it, as alluded to in my earlier mill rate discussion. If funds run out for the school to continue with unarmed security personnel, then why is it that the council just doesn't fund it instead of the Board of Education? Your proposal and that of the Board of Education's 5-4 vote will set us back another 10 years. I don't like the fact that the mayor seems to make all these decisions, and when listening to some BOE members at the recent meeting, it sounded like they felt bullied by the mayor to fall in line or else. It was said that he has the support of enough council members. The safety of our children in the schools is of paramount importance to everyone in this town, and that's what needs to be decided on. It's not armed versus unarmed guards or more security at the school in the form of very restricted access to the schools or who is paying, the town or the BOE. It's still the taxpayers. All the parties should get together in one area and come to a consensus for the safety of everyone in the schools. I had hoped to make some comments tonight regarding your year-end June 30th, 2023 audited financial statements to compare them against what was budgeted. But as of today, March 5th, I have been advised that they have not yet been published. The report is presently on extension with the state, and hopefully by the end of March, it will be available. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you. Anyone else? Angela, no, we're out of time. Hour's up. Sorry. You finished your statement. You had time. You should have stayed up here.
I just have 5 words to say. That's it. Baby? Sorry. It's really fast.
Angela Foss, again, I just want to state that I really do want you to also fully fund the education budget. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, public communication is closed. Now we're moving on to councilman communications. I'm gonna go first. Normally I go last, but I'll go first. Mr. Young, you sit in the meetings every week and you watch us. Obviously you missed the vote where the council voted for the security guards, not the mayor. I have no idea what your personal problem is with me, and you can keep attacking me, but at least be truthful about it, because everybody watched the council make a decision, not the mayor. The mayor has no authority in this town. There's 11 mayors sitting up here right now. So whatever your personal issue is, I'd be happy to discuss with you. We can go have a coffee. But every single meeting, I give you extra time and everything. You want to personally attack me? Let's go have a coffee. Let's settle this, because the people are tired of hearing it. Mr. Hosley, I wish you had stayed. I've had a meeting with him, and I also had a meeting with the Historic Society. I asked Mr. Hosley to put together a plan for the Parsons House, and we would invite him in as a special guest. Because I think every one of us up here want to see the house saved. But there's tension between those two bodies. And he wanted to come up and say what they did wrong. And that's besides the point. We want to hear what we can do to save it. So that's why he was not put on as a special guest. And again, make a plan. You know, he said it now. You know, we'd like to try to make a plan. I've been asking for the plan. And he's right. We are running out of time because the Historic Society does want to sell that building in the spring. So I'm telling him now, I wish he didn't leave. Please bring us the plan. We'll get you on a special guest and we can try to move forward. What happened in the past, what got us in this situation, is irrelevant at this point. Diane, on the senior repair program, it's free for seniors. Not at $1 million for the cost of insurance to insure the program that nobody ever looked at. Volunteers on town property are covered under the town's umbrella, not on somebody's personal property. So if somebody falls off your roof, and I'm glad you used the example of cleaning gutters, if they fall off your roof, I don't care what the waiver says, our legal counsel and our insurance company, Kerma, has said, you're not covered. The town is going to be sued for millions. That's not a free program.
Yeah, every one of us up here love that program, but it's got to be done out of somebody's garage, and it can't be under the umbrella of the town. We tried to get insurance for you. It's over $1 million if they would even carry it. They said they would probably drop us. That's how worried they are about the program. It's sad, but we're here to protect 42,000 people and avoid lawsuits. And, you know, everybody likes to sue the deepest pockets. Unfortunately, the town is the deepest pocket. Jen and John, I think John is the perfect person for intervener status. I think he would make a great representative for the town going to these committee meetings. I would be happy to attend them with him. I'm sure Mike could if he can get the time. We're on board 100%. He knows 1,000 times more than I do. I'm the first to admit it, but I'd be happy to join him. He left? Yeah, everybody who I wanted to talk to left. So please, I'm sure he's not home yet, pass that along to him. But I think he should be front and center on this. And let's fight it together. Mary Ann, the Parsons house we're trying to save. Amanda, you came up and you spoke about approving an 8.6 budget. But in that budget, there is no school security, none. And not one council member, or not one Board of Ed member made a motion to amend that budget to add the security back in, thus leaving it to this council to make sure our kids are safe. And, you know, it's funny, people are coming up and asking us to approve an 8.6% budget. How much money is that? A lot. How much? A lot. No, how much? It's not about the point. Okay, but my point is, nobody even has a number. It's 8.6%, and this council doesn't even have a budget. Do you currently have a budget in your hand that you can say you want us to approve? Because we don't. So I think we're a little, you know, putting the cart before the horse on approving the budget. That's like paying a bill at home and not opening it and just assume it's right. So until we get the budget, I'm not making any promises on anything. But I will say our kids' safety is number one to me. So I'll support that. Are you done? Can we continue? Thank you. George, the budget. Again, you come at the council. This council hasn't even dealt with a budget yet. So I'm not sure what you were talking about there. Angela, when the director of Public Works comes up, I'm going to ask for an update on the roof because we are under the assumption the roof is not leaking and it is not that bad that we have time to go out to bid. We asked in leadership, I believe, John, you were there with me, and that's the update we were given. And that really weighs heavily on a vote that we're doing tonight, whether or not to suspend the bid or waive the bid. So I want that information. Thank you for the information you provided. And then Chris, can we get an update for the next meeting on the roads 2021 on the schedule of roads to be done in the next several years? People are starting to ask. And then as far as the projects that are pending, Danielle, it's wintertime. Our goal is to make sure the lights are up so they can play at Brainerd Park. Powder Hollow's gonna be a tough one. We've all discussed it. Obviously, not because of us, it didn't make it, but we're gonna push to get the kids in there. Enfield High Drainage, I believe, is scheduled for the spring, and we're having such a mild winter, knock on wood. Hopefully they can get in and start sooner. Great questions, but hopefully as soon as they say go, we're off and running, and our kids will have something to be proud of to play on. But great questions. That's all I have. Councilman Santinella.
Thank you very much. First, through the mayor to the town manager, a couple of weeks ago, I had asked about ARPA funds and having the schedule of everything that we spent ARPA funds put under the ARPA tab. it was brought up tonight, and it just reminded me. I have not gone back to the website to look to see if that's there. Is it there for people to see what we actually spent the money on?
I've asked the finance director for the update, and he's been busy with other matters, but we will check with him at the director's meeting tomorrow to remind him.
That's fine. Thank you very much for that, because I do want to respond to a couple of the comments that were made about ARPA funds and how they were spent. If you go back and look, and when that's posted on the website, aside from premium pay for firefighters, town employees, teachers, we didn't fund our operations with ARPA money. We spent it on things like a band shell that's a one-time expense, on police cruisers that we were behind on our replenishment program, on the ball fields, on a number of projects around town that were not personnel. And we resisted doing that because when you fund people with a grant, at some point down the road, you create a big hole, and we did not want to create a hole. So I really would like those numbers to be shown to the public, and stop saying that we created a hole in the budget, because we didn't. We spent money that we had, and that we had a limited time to spend, or we were going to have to give it back, which doesn't make any sense because no one's given ARPA money back. So I want people to see that. And then we can have a conversation about what we spent money on. But we were incredibly responsible about not creating big holes in the budget with ARPA funds. That's just wrong information. I know that the senior repair program is near and dear to many people's hearts. And I have, as I promised you, Mr. Mayor, I've reached out to a couple organizations that may be willing to house it, that are not town oriented. And so I just need some more time, but there are a couple of people that are interested, because I know there are many seniors that find this program incredibly helpful. And it's just sad that it's gone away, and it's been gone for a couple of days and people are already looking for it. I was not here at the last meeting, and I want to take a minute to talk about the school security guards, the armed guard decision that we've had to make, and just sort of share my thoughts on that, because it's important to me that I do it, and I would like people to know my position on this. First and foremost, the headline in all of this is not armed guards, security guards, school safety. The issue, the headline, is our school budget and how we have failed over a decade to fully fund our school system. The numbers are dismal. And our cost, what we spend per student to educate our kids in Enfield, is among the lowest in the state of Connecticut. And people are shaking their heads, they don't want to hear it. It's the truth. If you know, we're an alliance district. If you look at what the cost of what those districts spend on educating kids in an alliance district, it's $20,000 a year a kid or more. And we're sitting here well below that. So the numbers don't lie. And shake your heads all you want. We have not kept pace funding our school system. The decision about armed guards or not armed guards was because the schools were going to have to make a choice. Do we cut $800,000 out of our budget and get rid of teachers? Or do we use the $800,000 to fund security guards? And that was a very easy decision for the Board of Ed. The guards were going to have to go. And the only option that they were given was that we would pick up that expense if we had armed guards. We were not going to fund the status quo. That was never an option. It was never an option. And in watching the last meeting, I also heard an attack or the insinuation that I was keeping my caucus in the dark. Let me just say this. For all of you who know me and who know that when I go to the school, the joint security meeting, it is very sensitive information. I barely take notes in those meetings. I take the confidentiality of those meetings very seriously. And I didn't tell my caucus what was going on because I didn't want them to know, because it wasn't time for them to know. And I explained to these three people here, when the issue was coming before the council, exactly what had transpired in the previous meetings and not a minute before. So yes, some people showed up at this meeting without the benefit of all the meetings that I had been to and the background that I had. They only had a couple of days to process all that I knew. And that's the way these security meetings work. I am not going to violate the executive privilege because I think I need to tell everybody everything, especially when it comes to joint security. I'm not going to do that. I can also say this. I asked specifically of the police chief and of the superintendent of schools if they needed to have, if they were requesting armed guards in our schools. Because I've been on the joint security committee. This never came up as a need. And the answers that I got are, I'm not asking for it. And I'm not going to say no, but it's not what I need. They need security in the schools. So we did not explore those other options. And I need to say that because this idea that we are leaving the board with no choice, they had no choice. We were either going to protect our kids with armed guards or nothing. And I think that the public should have had an opportunity to say more on this subject than it was given. And I just had to get that off my chest tonight. I also want to talk for a minute about charter revision. That is something that we are working on, and I would encourage the public to pay attention to this. I think that there are significant things that we have to take a look at and try to change. And you know, I'll leave it at that, and I'll say more later in specifics. Thank you.
Marie, Deputy Mayor Pisner.
Thank you. I do want to speak to you about the senior minor repair. I thank Diane for coming out tonight and giving us her story. As a counselor, we all have a responsibility to the town to keep us out of any type of liability. And as a former insurance person, I understand how important it is that the insurance rider would have been, as the mayor said, over $1 million. As a resident, I am disheartened to see this program go away. It was a huge asset to our town, and I know a lot of our seniors and our disabled depended on it. I will do whatever I can, work with social services, as John said, work with other individuals to try to maintain some type of a program. I would like to thank from the bottom of my heart all of the volunteers, past and present, that put so much into this program. They shared themselves and really went over and above. And I am very, 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 very disheartened to see it go away. But I promise I will do everything I can to make sure that we get some type of program back again. So that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Marie. Gina, yeah, Councilman Sakala.
Thank you. I will try to be brief. Just a couple of comments on the speakers. Solar farm speakers, we feel for you. Whatever is within the town's abilities, understand that we don't have a lot of say in it, but we will continue to help. Senior repair program, I'm sad to see it go, especially since it's been around for so long and now all of a sudden it's a liability issue, which is really frustrating. Board of Ed, so I've said it year after year, budget after budget, I am going to support the budget for the Board of Education as proposed. Ditto to what John said, I don't think we fund them enough, but if 8.6 or whatever that they're asking for is what they're asking for, I am going to give that to them if it is up to my vote. And I believe that's about $82.5 million, if Mayor, if you wanted to know, I think. Parkman Roof, just very briefly on this. So the original, and I believe I'm correct, but the original timeline and the original sequence of how we were going to do the roofs changed from the original to what we're going off of now. Parkman was actually slated for 2024, and why they moved it to 2024 is so the entire roof was age eligible and not have to do it in two points. So in two projects, like we had to do some of these other projects. So in order to not do it in two phases, we moved it to 2024 in order for the entire roof to be age eligible, which is 30 years. That being said, it was Fred Gerber, who was in Joint Facilities meeting with us, who did explain very eloquently how laborious the process is in order to get a roof reimbursement paperwork down to the state. We are working with the architects for the Parkman roof in order to get that done. I believe it has to be, there's some weird timing where it needs to be submitted by like the beginning of the month, and they only take the submissions in the first couple of days of the month, and if you don't get it in, then you gotta wait for the next month. It's very odd to me, but that's the way he explained it, and I hope I'm doing his explanation justice. But understand that it is on the forefront. We are trying to get there. You're not gonna see a bid for it tonight. You're not gonna see the papers tonight, because it's a school roof, so we have to do all of the appropriate reimbursement paperwork and get that submitted to the state. So that's on a different track and a different path than sort of the police and the library roofs. And lastly, PJ Day, listen, to insinuate or to think or to insinuate that PJ Day is anything but a phenomenal, worthwhile, amazing fundraiser for cancer research is disgusting. It is ridiculous. I don't know the last time you've been around any kid that goes to school, but they mostly wear flannel pajamas and sweatpants every day. So I think it's a wonderful, worthwhile fundraiser. I donate to every year, and maybe I'll be in my pajamas next time. But I think it's ridiculous to insinuate that it is anything but amazing. That's it for me.
Thank you. Mayor Bob, Councilman Crisati.
Thank you. I do want to just touch briefly on the school security.
I meant Councilman Mangini. Sorry.
Councilman Bob. I'm very disappointed in how this rolled out. We are holding our children hostage, and that's wrong. When I served on that subcommittee a couple of times in the past, it was handled a lot differently. We met, you know, an executive situation. We discussed issues. But then when we were done discussing, and Chris, you can correct me because you were there along with Chris, the other Chris, we brought our findings to council in executive session. And it was at that juncture where we talked about our findings and, you know, if we were going to bring what we found to a vote. It was not done this way, where it was dumped on our laps. Here's a resolution. That's wrong. And, you know, to John's, you know, point, I can appreciate, John, you know, the sensitivity and keeping information close to your chest. I get that. But at some point in time, the entire council should have been brought in and informed of what was going on. So that's a, you know, an issue that I have, and I'm not happy about that. The second thing, Mr. Hosley, I'm sorry he left. I would like to work on that group that he's referring to save the Parson House. And I think it's extremely important that because it, you know, has been a town historical piece, that we all join together and try and figure it out and what we can do, not just toss it away and sell it. And the other comment about the senior repair program, and I think Gina, you know, brought this forward also. This program has been going on forever, and then all of a sudden now it can't happen. Something isn't right. I know the law is black and white. There's no gray area. I get that. But there has to be a way that we can create maybe hold harmless agreement or some sort of MOU with people that are out there doing the work, because it is most definitely a benefit to many of the elderly people, many that are handicapped or simply can't perform basic house repairs like cleaning gutters, etc. So I would like, through our mayor, to our town attorney, to just explore a little bit, see if there's something that we can do. Because I don't accept this. You know, I'm a licensed claims adjuster. I kept my license. You know that, Chris. And, you know, granted, you have to be careful of liability. There's no question about it. But we can't just throw the baby out with the bathwater. That's wrong. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilman Crisati.
All right. Thank you, Mayor. Waited patiently. Thank you, Councilor Mangini. No, that's quite all right. We have to have a little chuckle here. For the past 8 years, I've worked very closely with the Commission on Aging and working very closely with Dave Goyette and Tim Slade and all of the other members of the Commission on Aging. And over the past couple of years, Deputy Mayor Pisner has been a liaison to that particular group. And she would constantly remind me of the importance of this particular program. What can we do for this program over the past 2 years? Because they did experience some difficulties and, you know, where are they going to set up shop? Well, I thought that we had a pretty good setup for them over at the annex. And now all of a sudden, you know, the liability issue with CIRMA. Tonight, I do have a letter from Dave Goyette that I'm going to share with everybody. And I'm going to read what he sent to me. And it states, I've asked my friend, ex-Mayor Bob Crisati, a longtime supporter of the Enfield Senior Minor Home Repair, to read this letter tonight as I have COVID and cannot attend. David Goyette, co-founder and director of the Enfield Repair Minor Program for the past 10 years, serving over 2,000 citizens during that time. I was notified late last week that due to insurance regulations and concerns from the town's insurance carrier, which notified the acting town attorney, who later notified the acting town manager, to consider immediately withdrawing all town support for this gold standard program in Enfield in the state of Connecticut. This decision effectively shuts down this program immediately. It is sad to see that this insurance regulations and concerns can control the volunteer efforts of so many folks over these past 10 years to abruptly end. Myself, the program coordinator, the many volunteers are upset about the decision. More importantly, the many seniors who relied on this vital program will no longer be serviced in the same capacity. What a sad outcome, David Goyette. I have to say that Cindy Guerrieri did send out an email to all of us stating that the program was going to end due to, and I was going to ask, what is the actual cost of this insurance? We've been actually paying $1 million every year for this particular program, or does this cover all of the volunteers who volunteered their services, because if you look at any volunteer in this town, whether it's the minor senior home repair or friends of the library or anybody, you know, we can always say, yeah, there's situations where somebody could hurt themselves and there could be issues. I guess my point is, have there been any claims over these number of years to make this program be abruptly ended? That is my question. That is my concern. You know, I'm surprised that Marie is as quiet as she is regarding this program, because I know it's near and dear to her heart, and I thoroughly understand the liability program. Attorney Tyler, you gave us a good explanation in regard to you know, the sobering facts and the data that you stated in your email. You know, and exposure, and you talked about best practices. Well, then I think that we have to examine all of our volunteer services here in town. You know, our best practices being used for all of them. I'm just hoping that this group is just not getting singled out for any particular reasons. Moving forward, I do commend all of the people that were involved. Tim Slade, who really organized up, along with Dave Goyette and all of the volunteers. You know, thank you and congratulations for all of your time and effort that you have shown. Now, this UR Community Cares, you know, I will do a cartwheel for everybody if they would, you know, come and say, oh, we'll help and we'll step in and we'll try to get this program off the ground, because it's a separate group. There's a group, this is a group from Manchester, you know, coming in and, you know, saying that we can help this group or we can help this group. No, we have a pretty good social service department here, and now we're going to have to rely on another town possibly to come in and help maybe keep this program afloat, if we choose to keep it afloat. You know, or are we going to have somebody, one of these volunteers, say, okay, I'm going to take this project and we're going to do it out of my garage. You know, and I look at door number 8 over at the annex, because another issue that we had was the safety during swimming lessons this past summer, that the entrance where kids were coming in with their families really should have been coming in through the front door, not the side door where these workers work. And then we had the issue where they were driving their vehicles on the sidewalk. Well, you know what? I've coached in that building. The vehicles were always used in that particular side of the building. So, you know, I get a little upset when I hear about some of the excuses. Now, did we make the program work this past summer? Absolutely, because they made the families come in the front door like they should be, to come down into the pool area. It all worked out. It worked out. There were no issues. They had custodians making sure that nobody interrupted on 15 minutes of one day, on a Tuesday, 15 minutes in, 15 minutes out. They come back at 12:30, 1 o'clock. Well, if swimming lessons started at 1 o'clock and they went till 3 or 4, you tell the group, okay, fellas, you can't bring your equipment back until 5 o'clock when nobody's around. Not rocket science. I am upset that this program is being ended, but I would like to know if there has been any claims that were actually which caused this program to go down, and if it really is $1 million, is the $1 million covering the whole town, or is this specific program? So that's all I have to say in regard to this. My other thing is, is this going to affect all the volunteers that help in town with this liability? Ken, you're shaking your head no. So,
can I
you,
just
no? Don't. When I'm finished, you can speak. Okay. So, but I'm gonna just leave it at that. I was not here at the last meeting. I do support the education budget, being a teacher here in town for just a couple of years, and being very close to what budgets are all about. And, you know, and it's unfortunate that we got into this situation with the armed guards and security guards, and, you know, where this actually came from. I was involved in confidential executive session meeting also. And when you're in an executive session meeting, you don't say anything. And then when it becomes public, it became public. So, you know, yes. And one of the questions that I posed, okay, well, if there's 14 security guards and we need X amount of armed guards, how many of the security guards are going to be eligible to maintain that position if they so choose so? And is our current security person in charge, the supervisor, is he still going to have his employment if he chooses to do so? And those questions were answered, and I was okay with it. When the superintendent and assistant superintendent in a meeting stated that we cannot fund our security guards, and we're saying that the town is going to fund them, what are they going to say? So this is where they're at. And, you know, am I totally in favor of having security guards? No, but I am, or armed guards. I'm in favor of school security. One thing that was brought up at the Board of Ed meeting, which was a good point, I would like to see some of this money maybe to go towards mental health, mental health education. And I think that is a good point. So people, Mr. Janitis and Ms. Pickett, I know that both of you would probably both support that, knowing mental health is very important to both of you. Also, I had a blast last week at Read Across America. All right, just to, you know, take the edge off a little here. We had a great time over at Stowe Early Learning Center. I had a fantastic time with these preschoolers. You know, it was like sitting around with my grandchildren for an hour, reading Dr. Seuss stories and having a good time. Chief, the mayor was there, you know, Don Ellis, Jason Neely, Aaron Riggett, Amy Morales, you know, we had Steve Belinda, you know, the old cat in a hat, top hat, you know, it was fun. We had a real good time. So, and one other thing that I am going to say is congratulations to all the Enfield Stars from Allied. This past weekend was the Winter State Games. Congratulations to all the athletes and to all the athletes throughout the state of Connecticut. I'm actively involved with that. It was a great weekend. And to top everything off, there was the Connecticut Chasers ice hockey team hosted the Eastern Shore Jumbos. And you want to talk about competitive hockey game that was great. Everybody should be proud of their accomplishments. And one other thing, and I'm looking at Solar Farm. We're behind you 100%, and, you know, who wants to have those in your backyard? No, nobody does. So, and I know that there is some state activity going on. I think there's a public hearing this week or coming up very soon. I can talk to you maybe after about that, okay? That's state of Connecticut. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilman Hendrickson.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This is my first time sitting on the council, and I know when I ran, I did some previous meetings ahead of time, and I watched the budget from the year previous. As a councilor, I think our number one priority and the one thing that we will lose sleep over is the budget. We're entrusted with the taxpayers' money and how to spend it. And what I've watched and what I've heard the last little bit, I've done budgets in my previous job, and it's always a pushback. It's always a ask for the moon, push back, and settle somewhere in the middle. I am watching counselors and people out there saying, we approve, we approve. It's great, no problem. With no pushback, no line item, no knowledge of what the budget is even, it seems to me. Maybe they've done more research, but I haven't seen these numbers. I've just seen 8.68 for school. I've seen every department head come in here and give numbers, which are sombering to say the least, but that's their job, to come and ask for money. Our job is to make sure we can afford it, the taxpayer can afford it, and we agree on a budget that is payable by every taxpayer here. There's fixed costs, I understand. I've done budgets, there's unfixed costs. We have to do our job and look at these and come up with the best plan. It is not an easy job. It is one we will lose sleep over. People may lose jobs. It's not easy. I've done lots of budgets. It's not an easy thing. But to sit up here and make it easy and just say, okay, it's great, we're gonna approve everything, seems irresponsible to me. I'm looking forward to the budget. And I will be pushing back as hard as I can to make sure we get every dollar and every value we can out of every dollar. That's all I have to say for today.
Anyone else? Councilor Nasuda.
The only thing I want to just bring up is the, through the mayor. Well, he's not there. to the town manager is I got a call regarding the streetlights on Freshwater Boulevard between South and all the way past Steppendorf are not working. It's kind of a dark road. People who called me don't feel safe driving down it. That's all I got.
Councilor Finger?
Thank you, stand-in mayor. Appreciate it.
Anytime.
You bet. Through the real mayor who's just sat down, to the town manager, the barcode on the panhandler sign, in case people don't know, we put out panhandling signs around town, and the malls and stuff are joining in with us. The barcode, remember, didn't work when people scanned it because they didn't go to the website. Do you know if that was corrected or not? We can find out for me, please. And that's the first thing. My understanding is, maybe Jim or Gina can clarify, I thought the Parkman School roof automatically has to go out to bid, so it's not part of what we're doing tonight, if that's correct. All right, so good. So far, I'm batting two for two. Three, this one, George, I don't mean this in a mean way, my friend, but if you don't know me by now, nobody bullies me, okay? Not him, not the past mayor or the mayor before that. These people will tell you nobody bullies anybody. All right, the town manager doesn't bully anybody. Nobody does, okay? Only person, one person bullies me, that's my wife. Okay, that's it. You didn't say that. So the whole thing is that these are things that you're assuming. So these things you're assuming are wrong, and you did say that. So just to let you know that I vote the way I want to vote. You can ask the past party, you can ask the present party. There's nothing but respect out of a lot of people up here. Everybody deserves what they said or what they do up here, no matter what anybody else thinks about what they say and or do. We all deserve respect and no hatred. And I think, yeah, it's a short one tonight. Again, I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just wanted to make a few remarks on Mr. Hosley and Ms. Turner's comments about the Martha Parsons House. I think that really is an asset to our town. I know some time ago the JI did an article, and it was quite extensive discussing it. But not everybody gets the paper, not everybody takes the time to read an article about a historic home in town. So maybe people watching and listening can think about it, come up with some ideas to how to remedy this. You can volunteer and help support a committee if they can form one. I personally would like to help remedy and save the house. Also, in regard to the senior repair program, I worked with Councillor Crisati for years on the Commission on Aging, and it was a great success. It was a real godsend to our community. And I've got a few ideas that maybe I can share with you, and we can have a new twist on this. But I'd like to see it continue because a lot of people really need the help. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilman Ludwig.
I wasn't going to say anything tonight, but I have to. Chris, real quick, through the mayor to town manager. When's the deadline for the senior circuit breaker tax credit? I know it's a different name, but we call it the circuit breaker. Isn't it soon? I thought it was April.
I'll love to check with John.
Can we put on our website to remind seniors? I think they have to go right to Alcorn to apply, if I'm correct. So that's an important, again, the council fully funds it. The state cut that program years ago, and we're at $750,000 of town funds, meaning the local taxpayer. So if we could put that, it'd be great. And the DPW information, again, I just want to recognize what some people, DPW subcommittee, Donald, our director, put together a fantastic, you know, spreadsheet. I would, if he can't go over it in public, but at some point, so people know some of the questions on the CIP. So we're actually are asking these questions in the subcommittee. Donald, to his credit, put this together. It's a great little exhibit that shows all the projects, which is two pages of taxpayer money being projects all over town. I think it should be a public information, along with, again, the director of finance, which is our general governance subcommittee, again, tracking our payment, how we're collecting taxes, which is one of the key, you know, really thresholds if people are falling behind on paying their mortgages, you know, depending on what the economy is. And good news so far, our tax collections are pretty constant. But this stuff is what we're trying to do to make sure that when people talk about the budget, that's going on. Again, another great presentation and that, you know, maybe the public could see, because I think we are tracking how we're spending your money. And so through the mayor to hopefully the town attorney will address the intervener status and a public hearing. Again, we are formally requesting a public hearing in Enfield, not a submission, you know, statewide. You know, I think I know, and I'll say this, I want to recognize Mr. Zach Zanoni, who did put in he sent us a letter. Mm-hmm. He put a nice speech into he submitted it to the, which I know he has some personal, you know, things with farms. But again, real nice presentation that he sent. It's a good credit for him. All right, we are doing our part in Enfield. We've done our part, and enough's enough, especially in someone's backyard. Again, for me, I'm one vote. I'm willing to go all the way to bat to prevent this from coming to Enfield. I don't care what that means. If it's suing, whatever it needs to be, I want to make sure that we exhaust, not just say, I don't want to just wish them well. I want to be right there with them, fighting all the way to as much as legal authority we have as a municipality, which we have more than we think, by the way, you know, that we can help try to stop this. So, I mean, if you give an update, I'd appreciate it. And again, just two things. I mean, again, a lot of things being talked about, budget. Just want to remind people that you can actually go online, February 5th, special meeting, 5:30 in security. Skidico room, item C, matters concerning security. The entire council got the presentation, as the Board of Ed did as well. So it wasn't just a subcommittee. It's public information. Go look for it yourself. And the other thing, when it comes to education, I want to say this, and I know when we get to the budget, it would be great if we could show the public how much the Enfield taxpayer, because the taxpayer funds the budget, how much on the town side that we're helping the board out, whether it be the IT cost, the cost of the buildings, the facilities, the taxpayers, to their credit. Again, I say this almost every year. Back in the 2000s, they funded the money for the improvement in the libraries and the gyms, which now we have issues with the roofs back then. They funded JFK. They funded Enfield High School. They have done their part. They're funding roofs. So when you talk about spending per child, Enfield, most school systems actually include their their budgets include, you know, buildings and grounds. It's in our side of the budget, along with IT, which is a big one. I know IT costs, we cover a lot of that cost. So if we can get a true number to show people what the Enfield taxpayer is funding, which is a lot, because the Enfield taxpayer is generous when it comes to education. And it's amazing as we sit here. I was on a council in the 90s. It's the same argument. The only solution is more money. That's it. It's the only solution. It's all we come up with, more money. Here we are in 20, whatever it is, 23, and it's the same argument. And yet a council, which some people on this council back in 2018, when the state of Connecticut cut the ECS cost grant, again, that's the funding grant from the state of Connecticut that funds local education. It was cut almost $8 million. The council, both Republicans and Democrats at that time, cut across the board on the town side, so we did not touch the board budget. That's what has happened over the last 25 years in the town of Enfield. And I'm tired of hearing it. It's people come up and don't touch a budget. I mean, look, it's our job to touch a budget. Okay? And the true numbers, and again, I want to hear what the true number is per student that people will accept. What is the number? It's not, can't be the answer more. What is the number people feel that is the right number to fund a child? So we get the best, and we're number one in the state in performance. Again, there's got to be some outcome out of this. So when I want to know what it is, because I want to be the number one school system in the state. Tell me what this cost per child is. Because again, that's what we need to show the taxpayer, that the Enfield taxpayer funds education generously, and we fund it on both sides of the budget. And I'm using Jack Sheridan. I don't care what pocket it comes out of. It's still coming out of the Enfield taxpayer. And it's more than what the state will show. We're not one of the lowest costs in the state. I don't believe that. Those numbers aren't true. And if we can get that through the budget, that, again, we show exactly how much we're funding and help would be great through the mayor to the town manager. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman Ludwig. Unfortunately, I beat you to the punch because I asked the town manager a week ago. So at budget time, we have those numbers because I think every one of us up here want to show the true cost. You know, I'm going to say after tonight, this is one of the reasons why it's kind of nice to serve in the minority, because you can say whatever you want. It doesn't matter. You don't have to have no facts behind it. If we underfund education so bad in the last 2 years, why didn't they increase the budget more than what they asked for? They had the reins. They had the Board of Education. They could have thrown all the money at it. You know, why stop at a 10% tax increase to the residents? They could have gone 20. You know, Mike covered the executive sessions. And again, to state that you're uninformed, they have two choices. They're against security for our children, or they're going to say they're uninformed. We've proved every single one of them was informed equally along. Yes, the security committee got the ball up and running, which I think a simple thank you. As soon as the superintendent of schools comes to us and says, we're cutting the guards, they're gone. A simple thank you for the town council stepping up to make sure our children are safe would be appropriate. But I'm not letting the kids go without security. And the Board of Education, Councilman Santinella, the 8.6% they're asking for doesn't have security in it. Doesn't. Why didn't they ask for 11 or 12 or 15 to include security? They never asked us for it. They just cut it. So that's, I mean, it's not, no, I don't. This is not a council. We were backed in a corner. Absolutely, we're not letting our children go without security. As far as the senior repair program, this was discussed under Ellen, when Ellen was leadership, when she was the town manager. Myself, Mayor Crisati, were in leadership. When I brought up the question, who is the licensee for this program? Because you have to have a contractor's license. And who holds the liability and workers' comp on these employees? Ellen looked at me with her jaw open. And that was the beginning of the end of the program. I'm sorry, but as a council member sitting up here, to allow a 70-year-old gentleman or female to go up on a roof and clean gutters off of town property with no insurance, no workers' comp, that's fiscally irresponsible. And it can't happen. And yes, they can run the program out of one of their garages. They can do it as a volunteer program. They just can't do it under the umbrella of the town. And I love how everybody's saying, oh, well, what about Friends of the Senior Center and all the other volunteers? They're going to have to go too. They're on town property. They're not on the second floor of somebody's roof cleaning gutters. We're not comparing apples and oranges here. So, again, being in the minority, it's easy because you could say whatever you want. Unfortunately, I will fight fire with fire, and I state it with the facts. That's all I have. Thank you. Town manager's report.
Thank you. Good evening. A couple of matters to address. I think you'll be favorably disposed. Mr. Belinda will be discussing the salary of our economic development director, whom is for your consideration this evening. He's quite an accomplished person. I think we're very lucky to get him. And it dovetails nicely with all of the historical concerns and concerns about our heritage, as he has quite a background in economic development, but also in historical landmarks, is currently the executive director of Connecticut Landmarks, with Mr. Hosley, talked about the several properties around the state that they manage. We're very impressed with him. We're very happy that he'll be coming on board the beginning of April. I would ask that we defer having Mr. Hosley as a guest until Aaron is on board so that they can talk and discuss things. I'm excited for the future. He's very well informed. He thinks that we have underutilized our tourism potential in Enfield, our historical sites, our position on the Connecticut River, with some national universities coming up. He said there will be tourism dollars available. So I think he's going to be a good fit, not only to help us with all of our other economic development projects, but with preserving our historical and our heritage history here in Enfield. So Steve will be talking about him in a little bit. In regard to the reason why we sent Nathan Hale out again for a request for proposal is because, fortunately, we've had quite a bit of interest in it. We've had some competing developers, three or four that are very serious, that are interested in the property. We couldn't pick winners or losers. We went out, we codified after as many years as Mr. Young stated, to go out for RFP so the council can consider each and every project on its merits, the financial backing, the impact, the various changes it might necessitate in the neighborhoods under planning and zoning. But we were happy that we had so many competing interests so that we had to come back to the council. Previously, I think it had been envisioned the property would be given away, and I don't think we're in that position any longer. I think that we actually would be able to have a sale to an interested party, and there are a few. So that's good news. in regard to DPW projects, we will, I think, Mr. Ludwig, place that on the Public Works website with a link to the managers. I used to do updates last time on our projects for Public Works. I like Danielle's suggestion. I think it would be very informative to put it on our Facebook. We meet with Donald every week. He gives us the updates on all of the many varied projects underway, and I think that's a great idea to, again, just put it right out there when it went out to bid, when the bid was awarded, what the time frame is, all of the specifics, so people who are interested, whether it's sports or otherwise, or roofs or roads, would be able to get a firsthand account up to date from Public Works. We did do that previously, and we'll do it again. I think it's a great idea. And I think that covers it for me. I would just say, in regard to the senior repair program, you're right. It's something that was on my plate when I came in with these various questions about liability and location. We were working on concurrent paths in regard to a location. I think we found a really wonderful one that was a standalone building for them, had its own alarm and a bathroom, but it was had to be traversed across a sidewalk, and we were looking at that. But at the same time, because Marie had also raised the issue of liability and waivers, and previously, I think in 17, I had issued an opinion, I think as town attorney, that we talked to Kermer at that time, and we should have had waivers from the volunteers and from the homeowners, and that had fallen by the wayside. So we had gotten those back up. The town attorney's office had prepared them. But then in the interim, we have yearly meetings with Kermer for our reinsurance program for workman's comp and LAP, which is liability and property. So in reviewing the program, they wanted to know more about it. We supplied them with the information. Unfortunately, and I've supplied their concerns to you, they are very, very broad, deep liability concerns that I don't think, frankly, we can address and still keep the program viable because of the cost of the supervision and background checks and licensure and all of the other exposures that they're concerned about. So we will look again at it and come up with a cost estimate, but I think it would be prohibitive. I will tell you that this is a real concern. A few years back, we had one catastrophic injury of a workman's comp of a police officer. It was accidental. Sort of a similar risk to here, somebody doing a good deed that was injured and ultimately went into a coma and paid with their life. The insurance cost that KERMA paid, what the town paid, because we're self-insured, was in the millions and millions of dollars. And as you recall, the reason we had to leave KERMA is because Matt Coppola was here at the time, and they had a, just like the meeting I had with them where this was raised, for them to review it. And again, they review everything. They want to review. We had to look at the SSO program. We brought that to their attention because that has to be covered. We talk about all the roof projects. They want to know. Who are the contractors? They want to know, what are you building? What are you doing? What pump stations? All of those risks has to be taken into account when they give us this new premium. But what had occurred with that one claim those many years ago, KERMA increased our premium on workman's comp by $1 million that next year. They then were going to increase it $2 million the following year. We were being priced out of the market because of one claim. And we switched and went to the Travelers. Took us all these years to reduce the frequency and intensity of the claim so that we could then be marketable again, because those claims stay with you for at least 5 years. And we had to work beyond it. That's what KERMA's concerned about. It's not a matter of how much. They don't want to underwrite it at all, given the risks that can be involved. And we have great people that did the program. I thank them. I asked Cindy to thank them. We're all familiar with it. The seniors benefited from it. But unfortunately, there are bad people in other places, in other towns, and in other states who do bad things or get bitten by a pit bull and die when they're elderly, or fall down a set of stairs, or unfortunately are unscrupulous and somebody is taken advantage of in the home because no one's there to see and they're elderly. This is no aspersion on our volunteers. We have not had claims to my knowledge, Mr. Crisati, but underwriters look at the state and the country and look at the risks and say, look at, warning, 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 these things are happening. And given all of that and the use of power tools and being on roofs and ladders, you just can't do it the way you're doing it. So it wasn't a matter of they're going to tell us it's $1 million or they're going to charge us $100,000. They don't want to underwrite it. And then we would have no insurance. And that is unacceptable. So on the basis of the town attorney's advice and their recommendation, I terminated the program. We can look at it and try to get a cost-benefit analysis if we were to implement everything they say. But it's a full-time supervisor. It's background checks. It's certifications. It's people going out and doing inspections. It's limiting the use of it eviscerates the program for all intents and purposes. So again, because of the world we live in, and because there are unscrupulous people out there, and because of the nature of accidents and litigation, the chickens came home to roost and the carrier said no. So everybody had good intentions. Marie tried to save the program. Bob did. We were still working on finding them a location. I was at the point, I liked the location we found for them so much, so I was going to say, can we do parking and go closer to the building for them? But then when the insurance carrier gave their final assessment, it became moot. So we thank everybody that participated in it. We're sorry for the passing of the program. And again, hopefully we can find some alternatives that will address the needs of the seniors in this town for that type of work being done. But I felt it important to give you the background. Thank you. And the town attorney, I know, had a couple of questions, I think.
Thank you, Chris. Town attorney's report.
Thank you very much. Just to stay on topic with the senior minor home repair program, when I first, my first knowledge of it came with an email from the adjuster. I then called the adjuster to see what was going on there, and then reached up further to get to the vice president of KERMA in charge of underwriting to discuss with her all of these ramifications that Chris had now mentioned, most of them. And we had a couple of conversations, and what I was trying to do was probe for two things. One is, would they cover it? And secondly, what's the price? I could never get a price. Basically, that's because we have all these risks that they were trying to figure out. Well, how do we cover these things? Secondly, to get where we could have at least a reasonable, feasible premium, perhaps, the minimum would be the town would have to hire at least one person overseeing this whole thing that then would be in charge of doing background checks on everybody that wanted to be a volunteer. And again, it's no aspersions, not casting any aspersions on anybody. They're going by what's going on in this area or in other towns, not Enfield. Fortunately, we've had the warning from KERMA. You've got Chris that's looking at it. I look at it and say, in prevision, if we know we're coming into a train wreck, let's get off the train because I'm so afraid of the damages that could flow, and not just money damages, but social damages also in the world in which we live. So what's happened over the last few years is that we've had an expanded nature and scope of all kinds of dangers in our community for a whole bunch of reasons that weren't here in the past 10 years ago or even 5 years ago, but they're present today and they're reflected in KERMA. I believe one of the other things that Chris talked about was with that police officer was that once they raise your rates, because you have had a claim like this, then that rate is going to stay with you or get increased more for about 10 years. And I think that's what happened with the officer. So I'm thinking, as I'm figuring out how am I going to write this to Chris, is what about 10 years from now? In the next 10 years, do we, because I could have softened it and then said, well, let's wait for a claim, wait and see what happens. But the devastating damages to the town, to the volunteers in town, and to the homeowners who are getting the work done, it's almost like no good deed goes unpunished. There's a lot of good deeds here that's happened over the years, and we thank everybody for them, but we got out before we're getting punished. Now, there may be some ways of putting something together in accordance with Councilwoman Mangini's suggestion, too, but I suggest that maybe with social services and volunteers, and they can dry clean it, run it through the town attorney's office to see what can be done. But I do think it's going to be probably cost prohibitive, at least right now, to try and save something for the community at this stage. So that's the thought process behind also my reaction in terms of doing this quickly, because I thought it was important quickly to handle it. And then the other thing on the agenda that people talked about tonight was the solar farm issues. And I just wanted to remind you that Mark Serrato is actually doing the solar farm stuff. This started last fall before I ever came on. And so my purpose at the last meeting was to ask you, what did you want to do? And Mark has been out for a few days over the last 2 weeks, but he is working on it. And I did ask him to watch the council meeting from a couple weeks ago, which he had already watched it, and he's familiar. I do think that Diane Stelmet, I believe, is that Diane? Okay, she's gone then. Okay, so she made a very impassioned speech tonight. I hope she's watching at home. And if she is, please contact the town attorney's office, and either by calling us or you can send an email to townattorney@enfield.org, and Sue Roach will take it and make sure it goes to Mark, because he is working on the intervener application and letter as we speak. And I believe it's March 9th. And John Fox also.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, I had you mixed up. But okay. And what's your first name?
Jennifer,
okay. So, well, anyway, you've got the information. Mark's probably watching also. And also John Fox gave a great speech with his. He sounds like he's done a lot of research. All of that will be very helpful, because I do know with intervener status, you're supposed to tell them why they should let you speak. And you can give your brief afterwards and so on. But that's what Mark is working on. And he is familiar, as I said, with the program. So I'll make sure again tomorrow that he's, you know, right on it. But he was on it last I knew. And then the only other thing I think to update you on is it's really, it should be on the back burner for a while, the Charter Revision Commission, only because we put together all the steps. I gave it to Sheila to request that she take a look and perhaps put in some dates for us. She did a great job in putting together all the dates, but it's not ripe right now for you to do it. Yeah, I mean, it's a year and a half away where we can get it for the general election next year. But in order to do so, you probably wouldn't have to have your first meeting to even say, I want the commission going till August. So you have, I think rather than complicate things by going through all the steps, I'm just letting you know that one's under control. You can decide when you want to do it, but you got a budget coming up too that, you know, I'm sure you want to concentrate on. And I think that's probably it for my report, unless somebody had a question I did not cover. Oh, one other thing. On the senior volunteers, this opinion is limited and restricted solely to that program. It does not apply to other volunteer programs in the town. So, yeah, this is it's severely limited to that based upon CURBA. So if there is some other program that you have a concern with, let us know. We'll be happy to look into it for you. But that's the CURBA one was based on just this program. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Reports of special committees? Seeing none. Oh, sorry. Councilman Hendrickson.
Sorry. Governance met on the 23rd of February, and Councilor Sakala, Councilor Ludwig, we had a great discussion on possible tax credits for farmers, and we've tentatively set up a public forum for farmers and the public on Wednesday, April 3rd at 6:30 in the Skidago Room at Town Hall to discuss some of these options. We have members of the Agricultural Committee and the Connecticut Farm Bureau planning to attend. We're looking for as many farmers as we can get from the town there. That's it.
Councilman Ludwig.
I just want to acknowledge that Councilor Sakala brings fantastic goodies in the morning on our meetings, and I totally acknowledge it, and I appreciate the eggs that she makes. Very good cook.
Okay, and I just want to hit on one. Myself and Councilor Santinella, we met with Zen Leaf, and they have a good story. They seem like they want to be a very good partner. I had addressed the blighted property at Outback. They were unaware of it, and they cleaned it up within 2 days, got right on it. They are working on their social equity plan, which would be somewhere in the range of $15,000 to $20,000 to the town of Enfield. And myself, Councilman Santinella, and I believe Deputy Mayor Pisner was there. We like the approach that, you know, since it is a drug product, we'd like that $20,000 to be used towards social worker, clinical worker that will assist our police department when they go out for opioid overdoses. Unfortunately, the emails we get from the police, 99% of these people are refusing future treatment or future care, even going to the hospital. And I do believe on one or two occasions they've had to return to the same address in the same day. So if we could have a caseworker go there and try to help assist them to get these people at least to the hospital, I think it would be money well spent. Keeping the money, you know, they're in the business of drugs, and this money would be in the business to get people off of drugs. So it was a great meeting with them. And they are going to be doing a big community conversation. Was it the 4th, John?
I was going to just mention April 4th. I believe they're going to try to do it here so it can be
televised.
Yep. For the public to come out. And I guess they have to have a public hearing, not a public hearing, but engage the public in getting them to get it, letting the public express where they would like to see these funds spent as well.
It's part of their social equity plan, which is, I believe, a requirement of their license to do it. So once we get that date, you know, we can set it up on the town manager's website. I'm sure the open forums and stuff like that will post it too. But for or against it, I mean, it's here. There's nothing we can do about it. So come and speak your mind. This is the opportunity to do it. Thank you. Everybody all set? Unfinished business, 12A, request for transfer of funds for custodial supplies, $100,000. And that was tabled from last meeting.
Donald is approaching to answer the council's questions that they posed at the last meeting.
All right, transfer of funds, custodial supplies, $100,000. Custodial services has expended, encumbered 99.8% of the custodial supply budget as of February 13th. 2024 and needs additional funding to purchase paper products, cleaning chemicals, etc. Public Works respectfully requests a transfer of $100,000 from salaries to purchase custodial supplies to be used townwide. Budget impact: there will be no budget town impact. Recommendation that the town council approve the following resolution. Be it resolved in accordance with Chapter 6, Section 8F of the Town Charter, the following transfer is hereby made from General Fund Custodial Maintenance, salaries $100,000, to General Fund Custodial Maintenance, Custodial Supplies and Materials $100,000. Date prepared 2/13/24, prepared by Donald T. Noons, Director of Public Works.
So moved.
Second. Motion's made and seconded. Donald, welcome.
Donald Noons, Director of Public Works. Mayor and Council, I have two slides that will answer all of your questions and hopefully answer all of your questions. So for 5 years, this is a five-year study of what was actually budgeted and what we spent in that one particular line item for supplies and the like. So in 2020, that was the beginning of COVID, we overspent because, again, we're trying to get used to all the new demands that came down for disinfection and the like. So that was in the first year of spring or whatever, or late winter of 20, that's when all that came. So we overspent there. 21 and 22, we came in under budget because, again, at that point, students weren't in school for the majority of 21 and 22, they were halftime. So we were starting to see a surplus. In 23, we overspent by $28,813 due to everybody coming back to school, everybody's in, inflation and the like. And right now we have spent, again, every 99.8% of that budget for 24. It has been steady at about $215,000, but to meet budget requirements, we've been dropping that down as part of, again, trying to make budget for what it is. So FY24 to date, again, we spent approximately $175,000 in paper products and cleaning supplies. $8,000 of that also went to building maintenance projects, which primarily goes for paint and for ceiling tiles, which are about $7 a piece. In 23, we spent $223,000 on cleaning, and building maintenance products were about $9,100. So the cost drivers, this is, we are getting hit with shrinkflation. I did have a couple props, but I forgot them in my office. We do have, our toilet paper rolls are not getting the length that we used to. They're same price, but they're multiple feet shorter than what they used to be. We have vandalism in JFK and also at EHS. We have trying to stop that. We are working actively with Principal Clark and trying to resolve the issues there to help us, again, cut down on costs for paper products. Schedules. The schools are pretty much open now 7 days a week. There's multiple time between sports and all the other activities that are going on. These buildings are being used primarily 7 days a week. JFK came fully back online, and inflation, just our standard inflation of about 7% or so. And yes, we do have some leaky roofs and whatever, but we do replace ceiling tiles actively. and that's where the majority of the money is going. And that's where we have tried desperately, especially during the COVID years, to buy products like for the redoing gym floors and all of our waxes and polishes, things like that, ahead of the July time when we're doing that. We just don't have that opportunity now, and we're behind right now. So right now, the third floor of the annex, all the bathrooms are closed. We've purged all of Hale. We have starting to purge other departments and other schools, and we are sharing right now as much as we can inter-schooly and interdepartmentally with products to keep our place going. So that is what I have. Thank you.
Would part of that include unshuttering Nathan Hale?
It was very, very minor. We just took everything that we could, anything that we could find that can go towards schools and town buildings, we were taking from that. So that was not a big ask on that part.
Okay, thank you. Councilman Hendrickson.
Through the mayor, Donald, the $100,000 now, how far, that's a good considerable amount of your budget for, is that going into next year's?
This
is just getting us through this year?
That'll just get us through this year. And if there is money left over, we're going to try to, similar towards the end of the year, we try to do a transfer at the end to kind of combine it and see what we can try to get to take the burden off of next year, if at all possible. Right now, it's looking that we're going to be getting through just through the end of this year. It looks like we will not have that opportunity to get some stuff ahead of time.
So that's a lot of extra money spent this year. So you're looking next year again for another big number, I'm assuming.
Shrinkflation's not going down. We went up the 7% in that line item at 180 something thousand, but I don't think it's going to be enough. But again, we working within our budget constraints and what we're told to do.
Thank you.
Deputy Mayor Pisner, did you have questions?
My question was really the same as Councilor Hendrickson's. How long was this going to last? Because it just seems like a lot of money for a short period of time when we're working on budget. But we also have to keep schools clean. So,
to your point, we will be able to make it through this fiscal year. And another key important point to remember is that most of the elementary schools, it's not just the bathrooms that we're trying to do. We also have sinks in every bathroom. So we also have paper towels. We have all these other cleaning things and also paper products in almost every single classroom that you don't think of. You just think of being in the bathrooms, but that's not the case in our school, and especially the elementary schools. So it is a lot more than just the physical bathroom part of it.
So it's more than paper goods then?
Goods, or it's cleaning supplies, it's disinfectants, it's all of the above.
Okay, thank you.
Anybody else? Okay, I just have a couple. Has the town ever looked into the cost benefit of going to blowers instead of paper towels?
No.
No. I mean, maybe that's something we should look into, because I know a lot of places are starting to do that. I mean, especially, you know, it saves the environment too. I'm going to say it's probably going to be cost neutral, but I know what the bathrooms look like after school with the kids and the paper towel. It would save you cleaning time alone. You know, maybe that's something we can just look into, just the town hall bathrooms. We're redoing them. You know, let's just do something small here and see what the numbers are, if you guys are interested. And then you mentioned vandalism. And you mentioned vandalism at our two new schools. Would you care to elaborate?
At EHS, we have 40 bathrooms. Out of that 40 bathrooms, 24 are multiple stall, multiple urinal bathrooms. They're not like a teacher's men's room and a teacher's women's room. Out of those 24 bathrooms, we call them gang bathrooms. Out of those 24, six are closed down right now to help try to limit the amount of the usual kid stuff, flushing rolls down the toilets. There's been some competitions for distance, if you will. You can infer what you want after that. It just adds up after going and just replacing that, and never mind the time for staff to go clean it up, and also dividers being torn off the walls and things like that. So that all comes all out of these supplies.
And this is in the brand new schools?
Yes, sir.
Again,
we are working actively.
DPW is security in the schools.
I said we are working with the principal and trying to work out the best methods to do this. But some of the stuff it's almost unpreventable. Again, they can't have it obviously in the bathroom. You know, we've been trying to work out better ways to manage the some of the vandalism.
Right, but a female male security officer can go in a male bathroom.
Understood.
And a female can go in a female bathroom. So yes, security would help resolve the issue. Okay, that's everybody. Good. Okay. Thank you, Donald.
Yep.
So, roll call.
Councilor Nasuda.
Four.
Mayor.
Suda? Nasuda?
Please, Bob.
What was... Bob, you got to take your term, Bob. Okay.
Four.
Mayor Nelson.
Four.
Deputy Mayor Pisner.
Four.
Councilor Santinella.
Four.
Councilor Ungayer.
Four.
Councilor Sakala.
Four.
Councilor Crisati.
Four.
Councilor Finger.
Abstain.
Councilor Hendrickson.
Four.
Councilor Ludwig.
Four.
And Councilor Mangini.
My turn now.
Four.
10 in favor, none against, one abstention.
Thank you. Just remember, you're last.
Thank you.
Okay. Mayor, Council, thank you.
Thank you, Donald.
I thought about that after.
Okay, 12B, resolution to approve 12 new job descriptions in the police department, tabled from 2/20/24. And again, I just want to clarify, these are not new jobs. They're new job descriptions. They're updated job descriptions. So I just want to inform the people who misspoke. So whereas the substance, no, that's the wrong one. Sorry. Do we have anything?
It's at the very end of the page on the page.
It's not in there.
I have it on the electronic.
Would you care to read it? Please, thank you.
I have it right here.
Sure.
No, oh, you Gina have it? Can read it. We're good.
Okay.
Thank you, Gina.
No problem. So this is the resolution to approve 12 new job descriptions for the police department, no budget impact. And be it resolved that the town council, Enfield Town Council, does hereby approve the above referenced 12 new job descriptions, date prepared 12/14/2024, prepared by Steve Belinda, assistant town manager.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded. Thank you, Gina. Questions? First, I want to thank you, Chief.
Thank you, sir.
I know it was a little difficult to redline everything, but at least we had a chance to read through and see what the differences are. Steve, also, HR, I believe, helped out with this, so please thank them.
Well, Michelle Gillette was a big help.
Right. Okay. And, Chief, you've had a chance to review these redlined versions?
I have, sir.
And they're good with you?
I've gone through them. Mr. Belinda has gone through them. The deputy chief has gone through them with a fine-tooth comb.
Okay. So I read through them, too, and they look pretty good. The errors from the last ones are corrected. So I think we all had the same questions, and they're right. So, Councilman Ludwig.
Chief, you wouldn't mind, maybe just for the public, why we're doing this. I know it's because of CLIA-IN. Just remind people why we do CLIA-IN. We are one of the few departments that were CLIA accredited. So I think it's just important to remind people.
Happy to, sir.
Yeah.
So really there were three drivers here, if you will. The first one was that the job descriptions that we had for positions within the PD ranged in age from 25 to 27 years old. And the kindest online source that I could find as to job descriptions recommended that they needed to be dusted off no more than 10 years at a whack. The primary driver, however, was that last year during our third year assessment, an online assessment that was done as part of the four-year CLIA process, the assessor, you know, sort of said, okay, enough already.
And it gets to a point, well, why is one more year a problem? Why is one more year a problem? Because at some point, 1 year is just too many. And last year, we got dinged for that. And that is part of our CALEA, which is the Commission on the Accreditation of Law Enforcement Agencies. That is the national standard provider that very few law enforcement agencies are capable or perhaps interested or committed enough to be part of that process. And we are one of only a handful of agencies in Connecticut that are CALEA accredited and then state accredited to the highest degree as well. Finally, during the course of the process, we also did discover that there were one or two instances where it appears that somewhere along the line, there may have been multiple job descriptions with different dates on them that preceded me, that preceded all of you, that don't appear they had gone through the appropriate approval process. All of that has been rectified with the retention of a vendor, a very impressive individual, the dean of business at Goodwin University, a doctorate individual who created a job task analysis, which is the large binder I brought simply as a prop, that then generated 12 new updated job descriptions.
Thank you.
Appreciate Thank you, sir.
Yep.
Okay, anybody else? I was hoping you were going to read that binder to us tonight, Chief.
Had it been earlier, sir, I might have, but I think I'd be pushing even the good rapport I enjoy with all of you.
Well, thank you for coming.
And, yes, sir.
Sorry it's so late.
Not
Roll
at
call,
all.
Please.
Councilor Nassuta.
Four.
Mayor Nelson.
Four.
Deputy Mayor Pisner.
Four.
Councilor Santinella.
Four.
Councilor Ungayer.
Four.
Councilor Sakala.
Four.
Councilor Crisati.
Four.
Councilor Finger.
Four.
Councilor Hendrickson.
Four.
Councilor Ludwig.
Four.
And Councilor Mangini.
Four.
11 in favor, none against.
Thank you.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening.
Thank you, Chief. Thank you, Deputy Chief. Okay. Moving on. 12C, resolution authorizing the town manager to sign an application for and enter into an agreement with the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Administration, SAMHSA, for a partnership for success grant for fiscal years 25 through 29, pending contract review by the town attorney's office. There is no budget impact. Recommendation that the town council adopts the resolution, whereas the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Administration, SAMHSA, published a NOFO inviting applications for their Partnership for Success grant. Whereas Social Services has prepared a non-binding application to submit by the February 21, 2024 deadline for funds that will be available to the town in fiscal years 25 through 29 to support the work of the Enfield Together Mental Health and Wellness Coalition. Now therefore, be it resolved, the town manager, Christopher W. Bromson, is authorized to sign and submit the grant application and subsequent agreement subject to review and approval by the town attorney in the name and on behalf of the town of Enfield with the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Administration, and to affix the corporate seal. Date prepared 2/15/24, prepared by Cynthia Guerreri, Director of Social Services.
So moved.
Second. Motion's made and seconded. Welcome, Cindy. Sorry it's so late.
Good evening.
Okay, I know we had questions for her. Marie, did you want to go? You're muted.
I wanted to hear her explanation first.
Okay, go ahead, Cindy.
So if I understood correctly, the question was that the budget, so first of all, if we're awarded, because there's no guarantee, we had to submit a budget, and the budget includes two positions that would be paid for by the grant over the five-year term of the project. So I believe there were questions around what happens if, number one, you're awarded, and if you're awarded after 5 years, what happens to the two hires? So my answer, having done a lot of grants in my career, I've written grants, I've reviewed grants for the federal government, for state government. I don't take it lightly, and I understand the issues that go along with receiving a grant and what's required of us. So in doing that, and in keeping in mind that we just finished a large grant with the CDC, this could essentially replace that in support of the ongoing ETC coalition work around drug-free community and reducing the impact of alcohol and substance misuse. Knowing that we don't have that one anymore, I see an opportunity for this one, and it was an opportunity not worth missing because it's going to help sustain what the community's been doing for over a decade. In hiring anybody for a grant, there are a few places you can work in. For example, the job description, right at the top, it would say that it's a project for this time period. In any kind of an interview process, you tell people verbally, this is a grant-funded position. When the grant is gone, there's no guarantee beyond the grant. In an offer letter, you write it into the offer letter. This is grant-funded, and it's not only dependent on a five-year award, it would be dependent on annualized funding, because every year you have to not reapply, but in a way you have to reapply each year to secure that year's worth of funds. So there are ways in which you can make sure that you're verbally in writing telling people the limitations.
Councilman Finger.
Hi, Cindy. So let's just say that it gets approved. You got 5 years for two people. Now, are these full-time people?
One of them is full-time, one is part-time.
Okay, so the full-time member will get benefits.
Paid for by the grant, yes.
Paid for by the grant. Correct. That was my next question, and I'm all set. Thank you.
Yes. And just so you're aware, 16 of the grant, only 16.8% of the money is going to these positions. The rest of it goes out to contracted services, social marketing campaign, evaluation, programs and services. We have a partnership potentially with our police department, doing curriculum within the school as an after-school program. So there's a lot built into the budget.
Councilman Ludwig.
So I just want to be clear. You said this is replacing. So are these to keep two current employees or to add two additional employees?
So it would be bringing on two new positions.
Again, I support everything you do, but again, I have an issue with bringing on folks when we're going to have a very tough budget. And again, I don't like funding positions with grants. Someone actually mentioned that earlier, and I agree with the individual. Even if it's 5 years down the road, is there a way of can we apply for what you mentioned, some of the other things, the marketing, all the things, you know, whatever other than can you split the grant, or does it have to be inclusive of?
It's it would be near impossible to do what's required of the grant without having these additional people.
And what will the people be doing?
So one of them would be a project assistant, and that's the full-time position. So that person would be running the day-to-day in support of running that coalition, getting meetings together, taking minutes, documenting. We have to enter all the information that we do into the federal data system. So it's the time of data entry. It's that type of administrative support. Yeah. And then the part-time position is for case managing for our 18 to 30-year-old cohorts that are involved in the Hartford Community Court.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilman Pisner. Deputy Mayor Pisner, I'm sorry.
So Cindy, it's going to be a five-year plan. So obviously you've worked it in so that they would get raises through those 5 years, or is it the same amount of money for 5 years? Are benefits included with the full-time employee? Those are just a couple of the questions I had about it.
So benefits are paid for by the grant, and each year, if somebody gets an increase in salary as determined annually by council and budgeting, then we would have to decrease elsewhere within the grant. We already do that with, just a reminder, 44% of my department is grant funded. And so this is something we do all the time. So we have grant funds, and contractual employees get an increase. So we have to cut other places until there's nowhere else to cut. So just to be clear,
the person taking this job would be aware that after 5 years, they could possibly lose their job because it's grant funded. Correct. They would take the job knowing that. Thank you.
I have a question.
Councilman Crisati.
Yeah, just looking at some of the requirements of this particular grant, once again, the grant, it does say for two full-time positions, but you're saying that, yeah, that it's not.
One full-time, one part-time.
Okay, so one full, one part-time. And part of this grant, you said what percent was being used for other programs? 18?
16.8% is for these positions. The other 80-plus percent is for contracted services and program delivery.
Okay, so when you do the math, do you think that there's going to be people that would want to take this position for less than minimum wage, so to say? Because if so you kind of figure it out, it's $37,500.
You're getting the budgeted. So for the project assistance, it's an annual request of $43,680. For the part-time case manager, it's $19,500. And then the benefits for the full-time position.
Okay.
So at a $375,000, yeah, it's a little over 16% that's covering that cost. All okay. The other money is in support of contracted okay, services. Because
myself doing the math, yeah, that those figures that you have would seem to be more than the $375,000 of the allocated grant. But
it's a year.
Huh?
It's a year.
Well, no, the grant is for.
For 5 years.
For 5 years.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yep.
Do the numbers work, Bob? I mean, because I thought at first 375 yeah, for five.
Yeah.
It's not.
No,
it's per
I got
year.
It.
All right. You're
yeah,
good?
Yeah, I got it.
All right. I want to make sure it's because no, with the increase in minimum wage.
Yeah, I get it.
Councilman Ungheier.
Hi, Cindy. So my understanding is you apply for grants, they're awarded, then that runs out and you find other grants you can apply from mm-hmm, to maintain sustainability. Mm-hmm. Will any of these funds be help? Well, you mentioned the ETC, but would it help with the CADCA at all?
Yep, that's in the budget to go okay, to the CADCA conferences.
Great.
Yep.
Great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Councilman Hendrickson.
One question, Cindy.
Sure.
The program that you said was ending, mm-hmm, was there positions there that are gone?
Actually, there was one program assistant, but we decreased that position toward the end of, that was a 10-year grant. So we decreased that position out because we really didn't need it anymore. And then we actually wound up getting another grant from DCF for our juvenile review board, totally unrelated. And so that person actually took that position that came with those grant dollars. So you just don't know what's going to happen in the future, but the grants is a moving world. Part of the requirements for this is you have to do your sustainability planning within the first year so that you're looking at how are we going to sustain the momentum and the work. Sometimes it is dollars and cents, and other times you build it and you incorporate it into the fabric of the community.
Okay, thank you.
Anyone else? Roll call.
Councilor Nassuta.
Four.
Mayor Nelson.
Four.
Deputy Mayor Pisner.
Four.
Councilor Santinella.
Four.
Councilor Ungheier.
Four.
Councilor Sakala.
Four.
Councilor Crisati.
Four.
Councilor Finger.
Four.
And Councilor Hendrickson.
Four.
Councilor Ludwig.
Against.
And Councilor Mangini.
Four.
10 members in favor, one against.
Thank you. Thank you, Cindy. Moving on, 13, new business consent agenda. There is none. B, appointments. Prison Liaison Committee. The term of office of Timothy Slade, Republican, expired on 2/29/2024. Recommendation is Peter Kula, Republican, until 2/28/2016.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded. Are there any other nominations?
Mr. Mayor, I have a nomination.
Okay. Go ahead.
I had a conversation with Mr. Slade today, and he would like to continue his position as prison liaison. So I would like to nominate Tim Slade.
And I'll second that.
Okay. Motion's made and seconded. Any other nominations?
I have a question.
Sure.
Doesn't he have to fill out this form?
He did. Mr. Slade?
Yeah.
Yeah, we have it.
I just have Kula and Pfeiffer Hall.
There you go. Huh? It's not in the pack?
I mean, I would support him.
We do have it.
Yeah, you don't. It's in there. We don't need it. We can vote.
Right. No, but I would like to receive it at some point.
Sure.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other nominations? Motion's made to close and seconded. All in favor of closing nominations? Roll call, please.
Councilor Nasuda?
Timothy Slade.
Mayor Nelson?
Peter Kula.
Deputy Mayor Pisner?
Timothy Slade.
Councilor Santinella?
Peter Kula.
Councilor Ungayer?
Timothy Slade.
Councilor Sakala?
Peter Kula.
Councilor Crisati?
Tim Slade.
Councilor Finger?
Tim Slade.
Councilor Hendrickson?
Peter Kula.
Councilor Ludwig?
Tim Slade.
And Councilor Mangini?
Tim Slade.
That's 4 votes for Peter Kula and 7 votes for Tim Slade.
Okay, moving on. Prison liaison, the term of office for Gretchen Pfeiffer Hall, Republican, expired 2/29/24. Reappointment will be until 2/28/2026. Motion is made and seconded. Are there any other nominations?
Motion to close nominations.
Motion is made and seconded. All in favor of closing nominations? Opposed? Abstentions? Roll call.
Councilor Nasuda.
4.
Mayor Nelson.
Against.
Deputy Mayor Pisner.
Gretchen Pfeiffer Hall.
Councilor Santinella.
4.
Councilor Ungayer.
4.
Councilor Sakala.
4.
Councilor Crisati.
4.
Councilor Finger.
4.
Councilor Hendrickson.
4.
Councilor Ludwig.
4.
And Councilor Mangini.
Gretchen Pfeiffer Hall.
10 members in favor, 1 against.
Okay, thank you. Moving on. Resolution waiving the bids for roof replacements at the Enfield Public Safety Complex. There is no budget impact. The recommendation is that the Enfield Council approve the following resolution. Be it resolved that in accordance with Chapter 5, Section 8, Paragraph D of the Enfield Town Charter, the Enfield Town Council does hereby determine that it is against the best interest of the town to require competitive bidding for the roof projects at the Enfield Public Safety Complex and the Enfield Central Library. Date prepared 2/29/24. Date prepared prepared by Donald T. Nunes, Director of Public Works.
So moved.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Questions?
I have a
question. Go ahead.
Is that still the plan? Is the plan to go out to bid?
Well, again, I'm just providing the council with options on which way you folks want to go. If you want to If you would like to go out to bid, we may not get the roofs done this year at those locations. If we have a bid waiver, there's a definite possibility that it could get done this year. Again, I'm just laying out options for the council to decide direction.
Okay, thank you.
Councilman Ludwig.
I just want to be clear, maybe I'm slow. It's against the best interest. So we are, if we vote for this, we're waiving the bid. We agree to waive the bid. It's worded a little double negative. I want to make sure I understand before I vote.
That's the standard language. It seems sometimes inverse because it doesn't say the best in the best interest. It says
usually we use
the
best interest of the town to waive the bid.
But this is the charter language to waive the bid. And in the preamble, it says Public Works respectfully requests council approve a bid waiver for the roof replacements.
So to be clear, this is if you vote yes, it's to waive the bid.
Correct.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Thank you, sir.
Councilman Sakala.
Just very briefly, thank you for putting this on the agenda. This is something that I requested to be on the agenda coming out of a meeting that we had with you and Chris and Fred Gerber and Mr. Nasuda and I. And the reason we talked about doing this is so we could go out, and we know several reputable roofing companies that we have a lot of projects going with now or recent in the past that we can go to and get these two roofs done really quickly. And so I think, especially with the library that has had a lot of problems and the public safety complex or the PD that was put on pause because of the referendum possibilities, I think I'm going to be voting in support of doing this so we can get moving on these. I think this is something the Joint Facilities has sort of been spinning their wheels on. So
I will just add that it specifically says they'll solicit three bids from I think the word is from reputable roofing, but they will have to come back to you with those three for you to make a final decision and approve it. So even though you're waiving the bid, they'll solicit three, and they will come back to the council for you to approve it. And that, of course, will be subject to any contract. That language, when we move for approval, would be subject to the review of the town attorney. Now, remember, this could take how many weeks, Mr. Nunes?
Right now, the library is at 95% drawings, and the EP and the public safety complex has not started design yet. So it should be relatively quick. I would say within a month to 2 months, we'll be ready to solicit.
And then, how long do you think it would take to solicit them?
Just a week or two. That's
so
it.
We're talking a minimum of 2 months to get back to the council.
Yes.
And if the council is unsatisfied, then we would have to start the formal bid process at that juncture. So just understand 2 months would be gone if you're not satisfied with the three or any one of the three that they receive. So again, it was for the council's consideration.
I just don't understand. I mean, 2 months, you're soliciting three bids. Why is it 6 months to go and let anybody bid?
And that's a question for Mr. Nunes to answer, sir.
Again, based upon what Joint Facilities has recommended, we're just trying to put forth other options to get roofs done this year, Mayor.
I totally understand that. Mm-hmm. That what I'm saying is, even if you went and solicited three bids, that's not going out to bid, correct? That's using three local vendors that you have a relationship with.
That the DBW has successfully used in the past.
If you can do that in 2 months, why can't you get this out to bid in 2 months?
I cannot get it out to bid 2 months because the EPD has not been designed yet, and we were going through as a package, based upon your recommendation, to go out as one package for both roofs. Mm-hmm. So again, because the EPD has lagged through the public safety referendum and that situation there, that notice to proceed to the architect has not been given yet because there was so much in the air. So that's the only reason why it's going to lag another couple months, is to get that design done for EPD to get it as one bid package. If we want to go separate and have one project for Central Library, one as EPD, that kind of flies in the face of having that economies of scale, if you will, again, having both of those projects together. So there's really three directions. We can go out to bid when the EPD comes due with all the bid specifications and we're ready to go, or we solicit individual quotes, or we go, or we waive it, then we wait for all that to come as one package again.
But you still would have to have all the specs for the EPD.
We do have the specs, but we're not going through the bidding process, which requires a formal production of a project manual that has to be posted to state websites and to what we normally do through finance to get that through.
So I would suggest if you do not waive the bids this evening, give him the consensus to do that on the EPD so they can be prepared as quickly as possible to go out to formal bid and with the library as well. So it's unequivocal. We don't need to come back. Either we'll do this process and he'll solicit three bids to come back within about 2 months for you to approve or disapprove. And if that is something council doesn't want to do and you want to go according to the charter and go out to bid, then let's give him the direction tonight to conclude the EPDs to what he needs to do and with the central library and go out as soon as possible on those two.
I will happily do whatever the council wishes for it. So it's just, again, presenting options.
Correct. So so a vote no on this means we're telling you to go out to a formal bid.
Correct.
There is no more communication about
Correct.
This.
Correct.
I don't know that you've ever gotten an official stop, or have you, on these projects. Because I know I'm frustrated. I can't imagine how you feel, because these have dragged out for years between, you know, the school modernization and then the PD, and then everybody's yelling at you, why aren't they done? Well, it's not your fault.
I'm trying to make things happen, and that's why, again, this was just another way to do right. so.
And then what I would suggest, I don't want to conflate the issues, but once we have concluded this and you voted, you did want to update on Parkman, and again, clear advice to him after his discussion of it as to how to proceed on Parkman to go out to bid immediately as well, so we don't need to discuss that again either.
We already did that. We did that last meeting. And Parkman has to go out to bid. Okay.
He can give you the update then and give you the situation as it is currently and what the time frame.
So he should have that about ready for bid tomorrow?
Well, let's deal with – I didn't mean to confuse.
They're almost finishing it now, Mayor, I think. I got a text. So going up for the three bids, are these – if I go on to two bids? I thought you said three.
Three.
Well – If we could do each individual project.
If we waive this tonight for those two buildings,
yep.
you're going to solicit three bids.
Yes, okay.
That's all right. No, that's all right.
I know.
It's mixed up. All right. So if we go on to the town website and go into where budgets, referendum approvals and stuff like that are, will we see these three companies that you're going to be bidding on there already? Because you said you used them in the past. Because I'm afraid that if you go to Constant Asuda's company, and actually, you know, his cousin has a company. He says, hey, I'll bid me and I'll share it with you. And he comes to me and says the same thing. That's what I'm afraid of. All right. I want to know these three companies that are, can I find those on the website that we've used in the past years?
Yes.
Perfect answer. Thank you.
Yes.
So I wanted to know. Thank you.
Anyone else? No. Okay. Roll call.
Councilor Nasuda.
I vote yes.
Mayor Nelson.
Absolutely not.
Deputy Mayor Pisner.
No.
Councilor Santinella.
Four.
Councilor Ungayer.
Against.
Councilor Sakala.
Four.
Councilor Crisati.
Four.
Councilor Finger.
Four.
Councilor Hendrickson.
Against.
Councilor Ludwig.
Against.
Councilor Mangini.
Four.
6 members in favor, 5 against.
Okay. Thank you, Donna.
Resolution
two.
No.
It's not on the agenda.
That's already.
It's not on.
We did
Sorry.
That last
yeah.
week, yeah. 2 weeks ago. Resolution to raise the starting salary of the Director of Economic and Community Development. There is no budget impact. The recommendation is to raise the starting annual salary of the Director of Economic and Community Development position to $115,000 per year. Be it resolved that in accordance with Chapter 7, Section 2, of the town charter, the Enfield Town Council does hereby adopt the wage adjustment and start the annual salary of the new Director of Economic and Community Development position to $115,000 per year. Date prepared 2/27/24, prepared by Steve Belinda, Assistant Town Manager.
So moved.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Questions? Comments? Seeing none, roll call.
Councilor Nassuta.
4.
Mayor Nelson.
4.
Deputy Mayor Pisner.
4.
Councilor Santinella.
4.
Councilor Ungerer.
4.
Councilor Sakala.
4.
Councilor Crisati.
4.
Councilor Finger.
Against.
Councilor Hendrickson.
4.
Councilor Ludwig.
4.
Councilor Mangini.
4.
10 members in favor, 1 against.
Okay. 14, items for discussion. A resolution authorizing the town manager to sign an application and enter into an agreement with the North Central Area Agency on Aging, NCAAA, for a grant in support of services for residents 65 and older or disabled, pending town attorney office review.
Update. Oh, Cindy, welcome back.
It's me again. Good news, this does not involve hiring any staff. We apply every year to the NCAAA for grant funding, and the focus is always on how do we serve our seniors 65 and older and those with disabilities. Our focus has really been on trying to identify and engage seniors that might be considered isolated. We had a program, the last two cycles of grant funding, we funded a specific program to try to educate members of the community on how to identify that some senior may be in need. We've had a lot of success with our first responders. That's where we get the majority of those referrals. But we also understand that there's other folks out there that may need supports and services that may even go above and beyond when we get a referral from first responders. So this grant offsets some of our costs. We utilize our elderly services care coordinator. We utilize our adult and community social workers. So this would be a little bit of money that offsets those expenses to us.
Thank you. Questions? Seeing none, roll call. Oh, no. Yeah, thank you. Caught myself. It's only items for discussion. Do we have a consensus?
Actually.
Go ahead.
It says pending the town attorney's office review. Have we gotten the blessing?
We don't have the contract yet, so the first step in the process, apply.
Okay.
If and when awarded, the contract comes and it goes to the town attorney for review.
Okay. So the way this is written then in the resolution then is if we get it and then the town attorney's office says this is not something that we would recommend, then we actually don't have to do anything else on this resolution then.
I believe that's accurate.
Okay, thank you.
But you have to understand, when we look at contracts, we don't go into the substance. We go into the formality and legality of it, not whether it's a good deal. We just, okay, thank you.
Right.
Grant applications are non-binding. You apply, but only when you have a contract that you're in agreement with, then the town manager would sign.
Is there an amount attached to this particular
grant? This one, $25,000 applying
okay.
for.
All right. Thank you.
Yep.
All right. Well, I appreciate you applying for the grants because it was nice to hear your 44% of your budget. Mm-hmm. I mean, if we can move it to 60, I'd be a little happier. But, yes, I agree with Councilman Ludwig. It's just the other pocket. Unfortunately, the other pocket's a lot deeper. So, I will never keep a position that's funded under a grant, and you will see the resistance. So in 5 years, that position is gone. That just got approved. But for this, I'm good. So, Councilman Ludwig.
Real quick, Cindy, do we have any, I know, again, I always ask with the reporting system we developed, do you have anything on with past grants similar that work we've done? Just curious. Do we have any data?
Yes. I can get you data.
I'd love to see it because, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes. We have data.
And just really, you know, again, what, I mean, so people see this, it's all high level.
Yeah.
You know, we've talked about what's mental health?
Yeah.
What are you really doing, right? And so, I mean, that's what, if you just give us some data, just to, yeah, I know we have the system.
Yes.
Again, just to show, hey, look, we're doing X, Y, Z for people. And,
right.
And because the other thing, it also lets people know, and I think the other thing we talked about, so many people, we do so much for the community, and most people don't even know all the programs that are available. Right. You know, and so maybe just actually talking about the data in public, mm-hmm. folks will know what program's available.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. You got consensus.
Excellent. Yep. Thank you.
I am the only thing standing in all your way.
No, you're not. I'm sure. I'm sure somebody wants to come up and speak. So. Go ahead.
Just as, I guess, a procedural question. So there is actually a resolution connected to this. So I know it's just, I know it's only on for items for discussion, but there is a resolution. So if there's a consensus under the discussion, can't we take a vote?
Wouldn't the resolution be on the agenda next meeting? Yeah. That's what the consensus is?
I don't think the resolution.
There's no resolution in the packet.
Yeah, it is. It's literally, it's on here. Yeah. That's the only reason I'm asking. If it wasn't on here, then I wouldn't be saying so, but it's written. We can wait. I'm just saying we have it. So I guess that's...
You got to formally read the resolution. All
right. I don't have it.
Oh,
Gina.
Yeah, I don't have it either.
Oh, Gina. Oh, Jesus. I do have it. Whereas the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Administration, I already read this, didn't I?
No.
Yeah, I read the whole thing when I first sat down. And you guys said it's an items for discussion.
No, it's different. It's different.
No, I haven't.
Mayor Nelson, just for the record, for clarity, I think it would be great to entertain a motion to move it up onto the agenda under new business and vote on it there, since it's under items for discussion, and usually that's just when right. Council's getting a heads up on an item.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions?
Hey, give me my paper back.
I need this. I got to read it.
Oh.
Second.
Motion's made. And
thank you, John.
Okay, roll call, please.
Oh, we got to vote on that, right? We all those in favor waiving the resolution.
Oh.
Right? Yeah. Waive the reading.
And now a motion and a second for the actual.
Motion to approve. Second.
Motion made and seconded. Roll call, please.
Councilor Nasuda.
Four.
Mayor Nelson.
Four.
Deputy Mayor Pisner.
Four.
Councilor Santinella.
Four.
Councilor Ungayer.
Four.
Councilor Sakala.
Four.
Councilor Crisati.
Four.
Councilor Finger.
Four.
Councilor Hendrickson.
Four.
Councilor Ludwig.
Four.
And Councilor Mangini.
Four.
11 members in favor, none against.
Okay, any other business proper to come before said meeting? Seeing none. Public communications. Anyone out there wishing to speak to the council? George? No? Jen?
Here to you.
Jennifer Krasinkevich, 209 Abbey Road. I just have a question. So are we all set with the intervener being appointed? Or I know we have to put something through by March 9th. So do we have that individual? Am I reaching out to Alex Fox, who was here earlier today, to be our intervener on our behalf? I'm just a little unclear as to how we left that.
We can have a bunch of interveners. It's not, oh, Jesus, this is public communications. I'm sorry. I can't back and forth.
Oh, you can't answer it? Oh, okay.
Council communications, we can't.
Oh, okay. Okay. So that's it? I'm done then? Okay. All right, thank you.
Anyone else? Seeing none? Okay, councilman communications. Jen, we can have as many interveners try to come and speak for us. I'm going to actually try to get people out of East Windsor to join the fight too, because the big part on the town side is them taking our strength away from us with zoning by them allowing them anywhere. So that affects all of us. And then we're going to focus in on the particular project behind your house. So we have another meeting scheduled Friday with all the area first selectmen's and mayors, and I believe Granby and East Granby were invited to come to this one too. So again, the more of them we can get, because Suffield's having the same issues, if we can get them all to come and then we go to stuff that they're trying to fight, hopefully they get sick of seeing us, you know. And I am with Councilman Ludwig 100%. Let's end it. Let's push it as far as we can push it. So, and you know, to the last drop until they can't, because they need to produce power by a certain date. And if they can't, they start, you know, running into delays. So drag it out in court, whatever it takes, just to say we're done. You know, we're not just open doors for regular business. Councilman Ludwig.
Just to be clear though, is there a deadline for us to formally, to the mayor's point, to appoint interveners? So what, I mean, I think that's the question.
My understanding is that March 9th is the deadline for the town's letter to get to the siting council, and that's what Mark is very aware of
and working on. We already voted on that like a month
ago.
We already voted on that a month ago.
Well, actually, it was 2 weeks ago, and it was on a Tuesday, and Mark was off sick the rest of that week and most of last week. But he is working on it now. I met with him again today.
So does working on it mean the letter submitted before March 9th?
Oh, yeah, definitely. No.
Can we get an email to make sure that occurs?
I'll make sure that he does do that.
What happened with North Road.
Yeah.
We council voted. We were against it. It never got submitted on time. And now North Road has solar fields.
Yeah. I probably should restate again. This is Mark Serrato's been doing this for months. I'm merely the conduit from 2 weeks ago to let him know this, but he is working on it, and I did meet with him again today with regard to it, and I know that March 9th is the deadline for sending in to the siting council that we want intervener status. So with Jennifer, I would suggest again, if you can either call the town attorney's office tomorrow and ask for Mark Serrato, or you can email at townattorney@enfield.org, and then Susan Roach will make sure he gets it, and I will pass on that to communicate with you so you get an email.
Attorney
to know
Tyler, I'm not
what's
gonna give
going
hard
on
time. The 9th is Saturday. We need to know by Friday morning that we have submitted the letter. The 9th is Saturday. Today is Monday.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to be difficult here, but this has to happen by Friday.
Well,
and if you could relay it to
I will
Toronto
certainly pass
get,
it on yeah, to please. Mark, and I believe he's watching the meeting.
Okay.
If not, I'll have him watch all the segments that are pertinent. Now, we know how important it is, and he does too, so that's all I can tell you.
Anyone else?
Okay, thank you.
Motion.
Second, all in favor? Good night.